Hello, and welcome to episode one, because the last one we did was episode zero. My name is Ryan Skinner. We haven't named this podcast yet. My partner just wants to call it the AlphaCast, which is bullshit, because he wants to leave out the other part of our name that's kind of like me.
Because I'm the alpha male?
Yeah.
Yeah, I am.
My name is Ryan Skinner, and this is my... And joining me as always...
Start over. Go from scratch. No, it was bad. Go.
Doesn't matter. I don't care.
Start over. Go from scratch.
Oh, I hate you. Welcome to episode one of this podcast that I'm going to call the I Hate My Partner podcast.
You hate Jessica?
She's not my part. Is it somebody your partner if you're not gay?
Yeah, she's your partner. Absolutely, she's your partner.
If you date somebody and you're not married to them, you're relegated to partner status.
But you guys are practically relegated to, I say under California common law, you're like married.
I can't believe you said my partner's name on this podcast. Now I have to, we all have to get our names changed legally.
We can all cut all this out and start over again. Hello. Take number five. Hey out there, internet land. This is the podcast.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to episode one of our podcast. This is episode one. Our last one was episode zero. I don't know why it's zero.
It was zero because we were just testing it to see what we were going to actually create this podcast into. But guess what?
Also,
we still don't know what we're doing. So this is like episode zero, number two.
Also, episode zero like reflects the zero people that probably listen to it. And this one, we might have one person listen to it. So like if we get two people in the next one and three in the next one, that'll make sense too.
It'll only take like 10 years to build an audience.
Hi, my name's Ryan. And as always, I'm here with my co-host, Kyle.
Yes.
Person.
Yes.
And we're here to talk about...
You know, I get a lot of like, you guys sound the same. Sometimes I don't know which one of you guys is talking. I'm like, what?
We're both nondescript white guys, so we have nondescript white guy voices.
I'm not nondescript. You're pretty plain.
I got scripts all over the place.
Yeah, anyways.
I have a high nasally voice.
I don't know what my voice is because I only hear it myself, so it's not the same as how you hear it.
You sound tired all the time.
I am tired all the time. So, what are we doing on this podcast? Why are we here?
We're going to talk about Seven Samurai, but we're going to talk about probably other stuff too, for probably longer than anybody wants.
Sure. So, if you listen to our last podcast, or at least we might set the rules again here, what we're doing is we're doing a biweekly podcast where we talk to each other about what have we done, seen, played, read, whatever, the past 2 weeks. And then we get to our book club portion, even though it's not a book, and we discuss some piece of literature, a movie, a video game that we... In the last 2 weeks or so, have played, finished watching, read, and then we discuss it like a book club. Hence the term book club.
Is somebody the president of this book club?
I am the president of this book club.
Can I be the vice president?
I won't allow it.
Fuck.
You're fucking secretary.
I don't get to be doing anything.
You're secretary.
If enough people die, I get to be president, though.
Me, mean me.
Yeah.
Well,
one can hope.
Bring it on.
One can dream.
So this week, or last time, we talked about we were going to set Seven Samurai as our thing we were going to do to then discuss on this podcast later on. So we watched Seven Samurai again, because we'd obviously already seen it before. Obviously, if you haven't seen Seven Samurai, go watch it right now and then come back and listen to this later.
We'll wait. We'll wait 3.5 hours.
Yeah. So before we get to that, though, Ryan...
Oh, my God. This portion's hard because you and I talk too much. But I did take some phone notes of things that happened to me.
And I told you things that happened over the last 2 weeks, something that's worth talking about.
Some of this stuff was so long ago, though. I'm just going to go in chronological order. My little brother graduated high school.
I was going to say from.
Do you graduate from anything? I guess you graduate from college.
You graduate from high school.
You graduate from, like, dentist school. No, he graduated from high school. So I went to his graduation ceremony. And it was outside, and it was hot, and it was mostly boring. It's just, I don't know, it's a lot of kids, and they all get together, and you can't hear anybody. There's giant speakers everywhere.
Did they make you wait to applause at the very end, or did you applause every single person that got called?
I don't think there was any, like, awkward... people scream, and they bring foghorns, and...
But did they tell you, like, keep all your applause, as we name all the children of the future.
No, they don't do that. Everybody, like, just goes nuts.
Oh, because a lot of...
bring all kinds of noisemakers and stuff, but it's such a big territory that you don't... Like, it's such a big area that you don't hear it.
So they were allowed to make whatever noise they wanted every time they called a kid?
Yes. They were allowed to make as much noise as they wanted. It's funny because... okay, so my brother graduated from the same high school that I did, okay?
Okay, yeah. I had to think about that for a second.
10 years ago. More than 10 years ago.
Yeah.
But him and I have... Well, no, it was 10 years ago because I'm only 10 years older than him.
13 years ago.
How's that possible? Because if I'm, I'm doing the wrong kind of math. Okay, I'm dumb.
13 years.
Now everybody knows how old I am. Thanks. Anyway, I remember the high school that I went to. I won't say what high school it is.
You don't.
It was super strict. Like, it's a public school. It was not a private school, but it was the second school in the entire district that make public school kids wear uniforms.
Yeah, I remember you.
Which is like a really, really big deal. Like, everybody else just, oh, you're in public school. That's one thing that's awesome is you get to wear whatever you want.
And they made you maintain a 2.0 GPA or they kicked you out, right?
Yeah, but they didn't really follow that. It was kind of more like, well, whatever. I won't get into that. But the best thing about it was they couldn't, or they decided not to, make anybody that was already in school that was already not wearing uniforms, they didn't have to wear a uniform, so they inducted the policy.
So you came in as a freshman and all the seniors.
Hey, who's freshman on campus? I know how to figure it out. They're all wearing white polo shirts. That was great. No, so the first thing I really noticed is like how lax they had gotten in like the amount of time. It's kind of fucked. Like, I was the astronaut that like went out into space and made that easier for everybody because I got Saturday school all the time from not tucking in my fucking shirt.
Wow, that's Saturday school for that.
But I didn't go to any Saturday school. Mm-hmm. I just didn't go. I got good grades. What are they going to do?
You didn't want to relive the Breakfast Club?
Yeah, no shit.
You could have met like the stoner and the pretty girl. And
I don't know who I would have been.
Come on, you're Anthony Michael Hall.
I haven't seen that movie in a million years.
It's, you want to talk about another good movie that really does hold up, Breakfast Club? I was telling the kids about it at, not where I work, but you know, there's teenagers, and I'm like, you guys, it was made in the 80s, but you should really, like, you guys would still, it would still resonate with them. Mm. You know what I mean?
So they've been doing interviews with, because they announced the new Spider-Man movie, you know, and the little kid got casted and all the whole, and director or whatever, but they were saying, like, asking a question about the movie, and they said they're really going for a John Hughes vibe for the next movie.
So it's going to be rated R?
What's a rated R John Hughes movie?
I feel like they're for like adults, but they're...
Literally, what rated R John Hughes movie is there?
I don't know. I'm going to have to Google that. But I feel like they're not rated R, but they're very adult-themed oriented. I mean, Breakfast Club has like... talking about sex, talking about drugs, like...
Okay, I see what you're saying.
It's like, it's actually a good example is Breakfast Club feels like the actual movie for teenagers, starring adults, acting more like adults, but how kids, like, actually for, you know what I mean? Like,
that's what I was reading this morning. I don't know what it was about, but somebody said, whenever you actually make a movie about teenagers, teenagers can't watch it.
You're reading something or teenagers or something?
Oh, somebody's saying if you make a movie that's actually truly about being a teenager, teenagers can't technically watch it.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Okay. So there's like, I don't know how this works. There's multiple valedictorians, but there was multiple speeches. There was like, there was a girl that went up and she got to talk because maybe she got really good grades or was like ASB president or whatever. Do you know how that works? Is there supposed to be like two? Or is there more than one?
I've heard that there it's like that where there's more than one now.
I'm so far away from being a valedictorian. I have no idea how that works. Anyway, there was one young woman that went up there and she did her spiel and it was like whatever. So they're 18-year-old kids. So they go up there and they do their like basic essay thing that they've been like learning their entire. They go, "We are looking forward to this, this, and this." Like everything's in series of threes and whatever. I'm like, so I'm not listening to anything. But then there's one guy. He goes up, he starts talking, and like there's part my brain starts clicking back on. Like I'm starting to like notice what's going on again, and I have to listen because I'm like, oh. This guy, this kid, super bitter, like ultra nerd, like fucking fucking hates everybody. The whole school hates him, and it's obvious. He's like, oh, God, what did he say? It was amazing. He was basically like, oh, you had to make decisions. You had to make decisions as a high school student, like, am I going to go to the beach with my friends or am I going to go home and study? He did that like six times. They were like, oh, am I going to go talk to that girl that I like or I'm going to go make sure that I understand my trigonometry? And like at some point he said something about sweeping. Like it was literally like a full-blown fuck you. You're going to be sweeping the floors while I run like a company basically.
That's awesome.
And then I talked to my brother just like to confirm because I'm like, it's not just me, right? He's like, no, everybody hates him. Everybody hates that guy. He's super fucking bitter. Like he took the opportunity to be in front of thousands of people to basically like
show off.
Yeah. It was pretty funny.
This is what you get for treating me like the way you did. Or
it made me laugh. It made me laugh and I enjoyed it so much that it was definitely worth going to the graduation. So that's my life.
So there's a story that we alluded to 2 weeks ago that my first note that I want to get to actually. the story of why GameStop doesn't accept movie trade-ins anymore.
Oh, you want me to tell that story?
I do.
Okay. So
that was the first thing I wrote down last time. I was like, I want to make sure we got to come back to that. I don't want to forget.
So if you've been around for how many years? Because how long has GameStop been around in the time since it's had DVDs, since it's not had DVDs? Like 10 years?
10 years or so. Probably a decade. I mean, think about when I worked there. It was after high school. It's probably 10 years.
Both worked at GameStop, by the way.
I only
worked there for six months. But
was it that long?
Maybe it was less than that.
I thought it was like three weeks.
It was no more than 6 months.
I thought you were only there for
holidays. It was longer than 3 weeks.
Okay, I thought you were just there to answer phones during the holidays.
But it was short enough that I don't remember much about it.
Yeah, I don't think you were that long.
Anyway, so GameStop. If you go to a GameStop today, they do not accept trade-ins on movies. Correct?
Even though they've got them everywhere,
they go and you can buy... Wait. Oh, no, they don't have them in the store anymore. I'm thinking of a different one. There's like a competing branch where you can still get used DVDs, but it's not that one. But you can't, so they don't have used DVDs in GameStops anymore, right?
I don't think
so. Like nowhere. Okay. I'll just say a relative I had. she had a disposable income. She didn't need to work, but she worked anyway because she liked having her own income. She didn't want to be like taken care of. She wanted her own money to spend, you know?
Yeah.
So what did she do with her money? Every week, she went down to because every week movies come out. They come out on Tuesdays, and DVDs come out on Tuesdays, I mean. And she goes down to Walmart, and she buys everything.
Just goes on the new release,
right? Think about this for a minute. Like, not just movies in theaters come out in DVD, right? There's direct-to-video, there's documentaries, there's fucking TV. There's so many fucking things. She goes, she buys every single DVD that comes out.
Like, goes on the new release rack and just, like, grabs it?
She just buys everything. Just everything came out. So, you would think... After a little while of doing that, she's got too many movies, and she needs to start, like, making some cuts, right?
Thinning the herd.
She's thinning the herd. So she kept – I don't even know how she fucking did that. Like, I really want to know what the decision process was between, like, certain things. I'm going to keep this. I may watch it more again.
I didn't know that she kept anything because
– She kept shit because there was, like – I was like, really? This is all really horrible bullshit. She's like, well, I'm keeping the good stuff. You know, it's mine. It's the good stuff.
Well, there you go.
So she invited us up to, like, take all these movies that she didn't want anymore. And it was like 1,000. You have to understand, I'm not exaggerating.
So, yeah, there is no. What you had was what was the physical method for moving these movies?
Multiple cars.
No. The trash bags.
Oh, right. So I had, you know, like when you get like a brown paper bag from like Vaughn's.
Yeah.
They went in there like side by side or something like that and you filled it the entire way up.
No.
What?
You came in with, like, black hefty trash
no,
bags.
No, I didn't. You're making that up. That's a detail.
I
no.
totally remember that.
No, I didn't come in with hefty bags. I didn't.
You showed me before you went to the store in your room, you had a hefty bag that was just pie, like, as if you went to a store and you were on supermarket sweep and you just held a bag out, put your arm on the shelf, and just slid them all in.
Like trash bags?
Yes.
No.
You had three of them that were big, like 30-gallon hefty black trash bags were just loose DVDs inside there. In the cases, though.
Shit.
You had three. You came like, oh, I got another one in my trunk. And you went back and came, brought another one out of the car.
To be fair, I only remember the story by virtue of people asking me to tell the story. So yeah. That's probably why I don't remember it.
No, you had a bag where you could like have poured it out and made a pile on the ground.
Right.
Like it just you like
roll around in it.
Yeah.
Which I'm not saying I didn't do.
Scrooge McDuck style.
Yeah. So what did I do? I called around GameStops because that was my first thought. I'm like, I'm not going to keep all this shit. It's fucking horrible. I picked out like... maybe like 10 movies that were worth actually keeping. And everything else was just like, no, I'm not going to keep this. So I called every GameStop in the area because I'm not a horrible human being. I actually wanted to give them a fair warning. And I said, look, I have 1,000 DVDs. I know you guys accept trade-ins on DVDs. I just want to make sure that's okay. I said, actually, the first person I called, I said, is there another one that you want me to call that you don't like? That like, you want me to like prank them? just in case you, and they said, no. He said, from what I talked to somebody that worked at GameStop recently, he said this sounded kind of like bullshit, but I remember him saying that like they actually get like a commission on it or something.
No.
Or maybe the manager gets to say like we had this many trade-ins this month or something.
Trade-ins was a metric that they like to use to help with.
All right. So it makes the store look good. So I took it down. I took it to the GameStop that said yes.
It makes it look good, but it's kind of like saying... you blew the metric out of the water because they're never, ever, ever going to be able to follow up that like that year-on-year growth. You just put a spike.
You had this really big spike here in June, but nowhere else. I wonder what happened. So I brought them, and it took approximately 4 hours to process
long.
All the DVDs. And I walked home with a brand spanking new Xbox 360. plus games.
No, it wasn't that.
Yeah, I got an Xbox.
It was a 360?
Yep.
So it was like 05, 06.
That sounds about right.
I think that's what came out in 05.
Yeah, it's about 10 years ago.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
I keep thinking of like what years and how old.
Time keeps going. Yeah, I got like that, and I got like Gears of War and probably something else.
Time keeps going?
Yeah.
You know what scientists say that you might, if you go into a black hole, you might turn into a hologram?
How do you know we're not all holograms now?
I know.
People think we're all holograms right now.
Crazy, huh? So anyways, you bought a 360.
Yeah, so I bought a 360 and some games. And then I realized...
Considering that you got about $1 or maybe 50 cents per
movie.
So
the problem is that there was a... Well, it's not a problem for me. It was awesome for me. But there's sort of a loophole where even if you have Danielle Steel box set that's like, who the fuck is going to buy this shit?
Yeah.
Lifetime original best of like DVD set or whatever, they still have to give you a quarter.
I remember because if it wasn't in the system, you would put generic.
Right. If it's not in their system of like, well, this is a price associated with this thing, they still just, well, it's still a DVD. It's a movie that somebody, you know, got a crew together and made and put it on a DVD. We'll still give you a quarter. That meant that I still got a quarter.
You got a lot of quarters.
I got a lot of quarters. The shit adds up. All right. So to bring the story home, the punchline of this whole story is the following week, maybe not that soon, but not that long afterwards, GameStop's stopped having DVDs.
Yeah, I remember
they stopped
that.
Taking DVD trade-ins. They stopped fucking selling them.
Oh, you know what? I remember they were like, whatever's in your store, once it starts to dwindle down to sell the rest of them, whatever you don't sell, they're going to ship them off to somewhere, like another company. They're going to sell them to another store.
This comes down to, I work in a comic book store. Recently, we had used books, just like used novels, like real books. Okay? And so...
And I saw them and I went, this does not belong here.
This is bad. We don't do it anymore. And it's for the same reason that GameStop doesn't, I would imagine if I had to guess, same reason GameStop doesn't do their movies anymore. Because you had to have a baseline. Like, people are going to clean out their closets and they're going to bring you everything. Here's the three books that are interesting, and here's the 25 books. Here's the Costa Rican Travel Guide from 2008. Here's fucking...
Have you ever been to, like, the dollar bookstore?
Yeah. It's horrible.
You can find, like, the 2003 San Diego University's syllabus.
Yeah. You find textbooks, all kinds of shit. So, but, you know, the owner, just for, like, the sake of making things streamlined, you have a baseline of just, like, just keep people a quarter. Whatever it is, just give them a quarter. It doesn't matter what... There's some stuff. It doesn't matter how little you're going to sell it for. It's just never going to sell. You're going to have it forever. Nobody's going to ever spend any amount of money on it. That's not worth having it in the store. I imagine that's probably what happened. Because even if you paid a quarter for Danielle Steel box set, like, what are you gonna fucking do with that? How long is it going to sit on this shelf before somebody's like, oh, finally, oh, there it is. Like, I've been looking for this. I am such a giant Danielle Steel fan, and I have loved the filmic adaptations of these novels in DVD form. It's not worth it. Anyway, that's probably not why it happened, but I like to think that's why it happened.
It totally feels like it, because
I feel like I gamed the system in a really big way.
No, it's not that you gamed the system. It's just that you overwhelmed. It was so big, but I remember after it happened, there was like... rumblings of like this person who, because remember I was working for a different store.
Right.
I didn't even know you did this until after the fact, or I saw what you had, but I didn't realize what you were doing. I thought you were helping your mom or whoever clean out just the stuff, and I didn't know what you were doing with it. But there was a story about a guy who came in and traded in like his life of DVDs.
The DVD warrior.
Yeah. So I even had a speculation that like, no, it was that pushed him over the edge.
Yeah.
They were already getting to that point and they went, this thing fucking broke our system.
Anyway, it's a pretty funny story.
Yeah.
And fuck shopping for DVDs at GameStop, really. Like,
I told you, that's why like a movie stop, they were supposed to all go to a movie stop store, which was like...
I imagine most of that stuff that they got anyway, they sent like wholesale to like...
To another company.
Yeah, yeah, to something else.
To someone who sold used products and stuff. Yeah.
So I have more things to talk about if you want to hear about them. Or do you have some interesting things to talk about in your life?
I wanted to ask you if you knew about the Amazon Marvel... I took a note. There's an Amazon Marvel comic deal. They made some kind of deal, business deal.
Hmm. No.
Okay, we should probably have looked it up then, but this
applies more
to your
digital
clientele.
Comics thing at all, or while you're looking that up, I'm going to talk. This is one day we'll get email questions. That's so exciting. I'm so excited. I look so forward to like answering email questions, even though it'll probably never happen. So I commute to work like a lot of other Americans, and the traffic has gotten noticeably worse.
Not just Americans, fucking bigot.
Why does that make me a bigot?
You think people in other countries don't drive to work?
But why does that make me a bigot? I could just be like, fucking, like, I don't think about other people. Why are you going straight to bigot?
Because they're from other countries, so that makes you, you know, they're other nationalities.
But I don't want to hate them.
Feels like you do.
I just don't care about them. Is that the same thing?
Amazon's Marvel deal puts 12,000 comics in the Kindle store.
Do you have to pay for it? Are they free?
Well, I'm just saying they're on Kindle now or something.
I don't think that matters. The Comixology, you can do on anything. You can do that on a Kindle. You can do that on an iPad. You can do it on an Android tablet. You can do it on whatever you want.
I don't know. I just read the headline, and it seemed interesting. It seemed like something you would have
Amazon
a take on.
Bought Comixology, and Comixology is the digital hub for comics, so I don't really know why they're messing around with Marvel.
Okay, before the deal took effect, Marvel titles were digitally available in two different formats. So there's the Marvel Unlimited app.
Right. And Comixology.
And $10 a month. And then for newer stuff, there was Comixology.
Right.
So this puts all the old stuff from the Marvel app into Amazon's store.
How many? What was the number?
12,000.
Maybe.
So instead of having it.
That still doesn't sound like it's enough.
So if you had Comixology, you were getting the new stuff.
Right.
And if you wanted to do the back stuff, you would get the Marvel one.
Right.
Now it's like you don't need the Marvel one. You know, if this is actually enough, uh-huh. You could kind of just stay on Amazon.
But do you get it just through your Prime membership or anything? Do you have something you have to pay for?
I don't know.
Marvel Unlimited is you can pay a monthly fee or an annual fee.
The Kindle store allows curious readers to get into comics without having to download a comic-specific app or even open an account.
So you still have to pay for it.
So you wouldn't have to join Marvel Unlimited or a Comixology. You have an Amazon account with Kindle,
right?
And you have all the stuff there now.
Are you paying for it?
I imagine so.
That's stupid. That's for people that don't know what they're doing. That's for like, oh, I don't know how to find my way to Marvel Unlimited or Comixology, so I already have Kindle, so I'll do it that way. As a person who works in a comic store, it seems kind of weird for me to like endorse digital stuff, but like Marvel Unlimited is like it's a pretty incredible service. I don't care about Marvel Comics, but they basically have their entire back catalog for like a pretty low monthly fee or an annual fee, and you can look at that on anything. You can look, as far as I know, you can look at that on any, you know, tablet or, you know, anything, like any browser. You can look it on your computer. I don't know.
Yes, you can.
I don't know enough about this Amazon deal to make a proper comment on it, but it kind of sounds like it's just for casual folks.
It said it will allow Kindle owners to download single issues of the publisher's comics directly from Amazon's store. Spider-Man to Star Wars available on Kindle without requiring the use of the Comixology app. So basically, you don't need to be stuck into Marvel's Unlimited or Comixology. You can just be getting stuff on your Kindle.
But why would you care? Why not get Comixology? All right, whatever.
Maybe because people are not... they're casual.
That's what I'm saying. I think it's just for people that just don't know how to find their way to other websites. There's not really any reason not to use those other services.
Ooh, and their new stuff, it says. Issues now sold through the Kindle store will be available on the same day as they hit the store shelves and Comixology. It brings huge back catalog to Kindle owners. Comixology will continue to run both its apps and Marvel Comics app separately, as well as the Marvel Digital Comic Shop. Basically, it's another avenue to not have to have Comixology or Marvel if you just got stuff through Amazon and a Kindle. So I guess, yeah, I don't know. Maybe just it broadens the market for how to get to it.
I'm sure it's some kind of like cutting somebody out and not having to pay somebody.
That's
thing.
Well, like I said, if you're not paying for so if all the new stuff was in Comixology, and the only way to get old stuff was through Marvel's app, now you're not paying Marvel directly $10 a month.
You can get old stuff through Comixology too, but it's just not cost effective.
Okay, so I don't know. It's a deal that happened. Whatever. So, what were you gonna say?
I don't know. I have other things on my phone notes about things that happened in my life in the last 2 weeks.
Okay, so that's the Amazon Marvel deal that I want to talk about. How about I go into why I have not slept for the past week and a half? I have been playing XCOM. Holy crap. That game's really good. That game is really hard. That game is really good. I'm 3 years late to the party, but XCOM Enemy
Maybe
Within,
you should be more specific.
Well, I'm not playing the original XCOM.
There's like 15 fucking XCOM games.
No, there's not.
There's like 4 XCOM games.
There's 2 old XCOM games. There's the new one, and then there's the Bureau.
Is that really it? I thought there were more than that.
As far as I know, the Bureau declassified XCOM, whatever.
Yeah,
but it was
third person one.
It was going to be called XCOM, and they kind of changed the name on it. Now I'm playing Enemy Within, Enemy Unknown. Fuck, that game is so addicting. It has the perfect carrot on a stick. Every time you do something, you go, hey, let me just spin the globe a couple more days to see what comes next, or like, I'm going to research this thing. It's going to finish in 5 days. Let me see if I can get to those 5 days of research. Oh, a new encounter popped up. Do you want to handle it? It's like, well, I'll play one more map, right? And then when you finish that map, you're like, well, let me get back to finishing that research. And then 2 more days, oh, I got a new research. Oh, I can research something else.
When you say play a map,
Just, you know, a battle skirmish, whatever.
How long does that take typically?
20 minutes.
Well, that's not that bad.
It depends on how. So if you are a save scummer, like kind of like I am,
yeah.
You like save after every turn, or like you save every like 60 seconds. And if something doesn't go your way, you're like, fuck it, reload that save and go back. So one of the things they introduced in Enemy Within was it's called Second Wave. You could have basically toggle some, let's just say makes the game easier, makes the game harder, like insane difficulty. One of the things we have is called save scumming. You could say, I'm going to shoot this alien. I have 70% chance of hitting. Say you miss. I'm going to reload my save and try it again. Miss. I'm going to reload and try it again. Oh, I hit this time, right? Because it's 70% chance of hitting. You should hit it eventually. The game does not do that. So if you save your game and you go to redo an action, it's already pre-generated the outcome of that action. It doesn't matter if you reload your save. There's an option you can turn on to like have it try to do it again, which kind of makes you a pussy because you're like, I'll just save after every single turn and then redo it if it doesn't go my way. That game encourages you to not play like that. It's a good strategy game. Like, you like Advance Wars?
I like Final Fantasy Tactics.
You like Final Fantasy Tactics? I liked Wasteland 2 a lot. Oh my God, 88 hours in that game. XCOM is worth checking out. I was going to bed at 3 o'clock in the morning, like every night, and going to work the next day because I couldn't stop playing it. So
20-minute skirmishes, you said?
Yeah. But it's got a whole, like, you build your base.
Because that sounds like kind of a perfect, like, and one more. Let me just do one more.
That's what I mean. And then every time you're not doing that, you're building your base, you're upgrading your soldiers. What? Your feet smell?
Hopefully not.
I hope not either because it's a closed environment here.
It's fucking hot.
So, but it has all the aspects of, like, RPG, you know, leveling up your characters and then, like, getting new, not loot, but you would get new weapons and shit. So you're constantly just like, oh, let me do this. What does this do? So the game's very perfect about like not really explaining what things do. So what you end up doing is, let me buy it, let it do a thing, let me go into a mission and just see how it works. And in the process, you end up playing way fucking longer than you wanted to. XCOM, it came out like 3 years ago. Super good.
Well,
but why is it worth talking about? Because XCOM 2 comes out later this year, and now I'm going to be a day one buy on that thing.
Well, we're talking about a movie that came out in 1954, so...
I'm just saying, it's like...
The sequel to Seven Samurai is coming out.
It's random to talk about XCOM now, but I just got into it, and I finished it Sunday night.
Yeah, that game sounds awesome. I wish I had time to play it.
45 hours, I think, I put into it. That's what Steam says.
Yeah.
Which I... Perfect thing about that game is it's the kind of game you could pause, walk over, take your kid to go potty... Come back, resume. Oh, he's being loud. Pause it, walk away for 20 minutes, come back, resume.
Yeah.
It's a very good of like, you can kind of stop the action and come back to it again later.
I mean, that's a genre of game that I'm into. I mean, I didn't really get way into video games until I was much older. When I was younger, all the games I got, I didn't have any friends that like had good games, and I got like games based on, oh, it's a comic book thing. And what do we know about comic book video games?
They're not good.
They're all terrible. So I just thought video games were just big piles of shit. I didn't understand why anybody was wasting their time on them. But I did, when I was like 18 or 17 or something like that, I ended up going and buying Silent Hill 2, which is the basis of huge obsession for survival horror games.
Yep.
And Final Fantasy Tactics, which was kind of the basis for...
Wow, it's like you picked two really, really good things to...
Yeah. Nobody even like told me. I just was just like... That looks cool, and that looks cool, and that was it.
You want to talk about how we played Silent Hill 2 in our early, like, 20?
Maybe some other time.
That'll be a story for the next one, is what the experience, how we had to play Silent Hill 2
yeah.
at that time.
So the game's really good. I'd like to play it, but I don't know when I'd ever find time to play it. I tried to find time to play the video game that I'm into.
Which is?
State of Decay.
Oh, yeah.
And the reason I played it was because we were doing a bunch of zombie stuff for our new video.
And you didn't even talk about it at all, huh? It didn't even go in the
Today?
Video. Today? No, it didn't go in the video at all.
No, it didn't. Well, after talking about it for a long time, you kind of decided there wasn't really much, like it didn't really relate to what we were talking about.
Yeah.
That's a really good game. Everybody that I've talked to about it that like plays games, I'm like, oh, like at work, I'm like, oh, this guy likes video games. I'll tell him that I started playing a video game. And they're like, what, you're like this many years late to the party, or yeah. Like, well, it really should be an MMO. I'm like, go fuck yourself. Like, I play.
Well, you got like they re-released the remastered that came out not too long ago.
Yeah,
the year one edition or
something like that. It's got a bunch of DLC attached to it or whatever. But let me just say this, and then we're gonna move on. If you're into zombie stuff, if you're into zombie stuff in the way that we're going to talk about in this video that gets released whenever we release it.
If you're into zombies for the fun defending mechanic and not just like, zombies.
Even just the resource the problem solving aspect of it.
Scavenging.
Not so much the action like, oh God, I got to shoot them all in the head, like, you know, twitch aspect of it. But the actual day-to-day, how am I going to get by and how am I going to survive aspect of it. Play State of Decay. It's really good. 100% endorsement. It's a lot of fun. It's like Grand Theft Auto meets some other kind of resource management game.
It's like a game that meets some other game. And then it's like there's
It's got a Grand Theft Auto vibe to it. It's really good.
Open world, you mean?
Open, yeah. Like a big open environment.
Third person open world.
You know, lots of different things to do, environments to explore. It's excellent. I'd like to keep playing it. If I could find some time. What else do I got here? I'm going to skip this.
What are you skipping?
Father's Day, because I don't remember anything really. I was going to ask you, I guess. Like, do you know anything? Happy Father's Day. Did you do anything?
You mean happy Dada Day.
Happy Dada Day. Did you guys do anything? Nothing?
No. I mean, he was gone most of the day, so I got like.
That's pretty good, though.
I played XCOM most of the day.
Fuck yeah, dude.
Yeah.
That's not bad. I went to a breakfast place where I had French toast.
Oh, you
stuffed with cream cheese.
Wait, you remember what happened the day before Father's Day, right?
Oh.
Kid's birthday party.
Oh, yeah.
That's why it doesn't matter to me, because we're throwing a birthday party every year the day before Father's Day, so Father's Day doesn't matter because we spent the whole Friday and Saturday setting a birthday party stuff.
I golfed. I just go, my whole family golfs, so on Father's Day and things, I have to go golfing.
You are white.
Yeah. But to be fair, when I'm out there, all I think about is like, oh, God, we're in a drought. Look at all this grass. I'm going to skip this.
Good for you.
This guy was a horrible customer. I'm not going to talk about him.
Yeah.
I saw Inside Out.
Inside Out.
New Pixar movie.
Oh.
Okay. That was really good. You should go see it.
No, I'm sure. I mean, what I mean is like, I don't care.
Is your child?
No, he doesn't watch movies.
He's like too young, right? To go take
Let him watch
Pixar movie.
He gets to watch like, he watches TV like Blue's Clues and things like that. And they're great pacifiers.
Right.
It's like when they get old enough to take the pacifier out of their mouth. You shove a TV in as the pacifier.
Right.
Like, shut up and sit and do this. But it's great. It's Blue's Clues is great to watch. Like, he needs to eat food.
Yeah.
Calm him down. He'll eat food while watching Blue's Clues and stuff. Yeah. But we don't watch a lot of TV in our house for him. And as far as movies go, no fucking way. He's not going to watch a movie from beginning to end. The closest he gets to watch Nemo 20, 30 minutes at a time.
Yeah.
Fish, cool, whatever.
Yeah.
And Winnie the Pooh. You were watching with me that one time.
Yeah.
The Baxton.
Yeah.
Ooh, sounds like back soon.
Yeah.
He likes Winnie the Pooh a lot. Actually, he went to Palm Springs with my wife over the weekend, which is before we did this. That's why we had all the free time. And she forgot to bring his stuffed animals. He has a Pluto and a Pooh and not a tigger, but a tiger.
Mm-hmm.
But it's kind of like, oh, it's Pooh and tiger, whatever. She had to buy him like a $10 piglet at the outlets. She's like, oh, what do you want? Like, you're going to need something to sleep with. Like, he wants to have something to hug and shit. So he picked out Piglet. We're like, really, Piglet? Like, but yeah, he watches the Winnie the Pooh. He knows what Piglet is. And so when he came back, actually just like an hour ago, when I went back in there, he's like, I heard him like saying something. What happened? He's like, oh, he wanted his Piglet. I was like, okay, I guess he likes Piglet now too. So he likes Winnie the Pooh. He gets to watch the Winnie the Pooh movie. That's what I'm saying.
Mm.
But no Incredibles. Right. He knows who Jack is.
Yeah.
But he doesn't.
You gotta skip all that stuff basically watching a video.
But he's just not old enough. Like, I don't want him watching the whole movie right now.
Right.
He's too young. So that's why I only care about Pixar if Incredibles 2.
Inside Out was really good. Everybody's trying to get me to go see Jurassic World, but instead I saw Spy and Inside Out weekend to weekend.
Jurassic World made a lot of money.
Yeah.
It's actually surprising.
So it doesn't need mine then.
As much as I thought that movie looks like not good,
yeah.
I'm surprised it's making that much. I mean, I guess I'm not.
Maybe it's not that bad. I'm kind of like thinking maybe if I went to go see it, I'd be like, oh yeah, it's okay. Like that. I don't think that's the best it gets, though. It's not going to be like, oh, wow, that was really good. It'd be more like, eh, it's not that bad.
Someone had the cool idea of like, you know what? If you just release Jurassic Park now, it'd probably do the same thing.
Yeah.
It would probably make just as much money. It is a big, cool thing.
Right.
This is much more like...
Or like a remake of Jurassic Park.
He's riding the motorcycle with his pack of rats.
That's kind
of
what made me want to see it, because the movie just leans into it. It's just like, you know what? We're dumb. We're not pretending like we're not going to be dumb. This is going to be a dumb movie.
Right.
So here's dumb, stupid, cool shit.
And I can accept that, but I won't ever be like, oh, it's good.
Yeah.
I think it's stupid. I don't want to dumb things down for audiences.
You know what I'd rather do than go see Jurassic World at this point? I want to go see Mad Max for a third time.
How are we going to go see? One of the other things we're going to do is a Terminator podcast.
Oh, yeah. This will be the last thing we talk about, and then we'll start talking about
Not really.
Samurai.
But
no, it won't.
We're going to do a Terminator podcast, And so I recently watched 3. I watched a bit of Salvation, so I don't know. I got to find time to watch the other ones. We're going to watch all the movies and talk about all the movies because Genesis is coming out next week. Or this week. 2 days from now.
Yeah.
How are we going to see this?
I don't know.
I don't really know yet. It's 4th of July weekend and just...
Can't see it like Sunday morning?
Probably. I mean, we don't have to go together, but I know you probably want to, so...
I don't care.
Because if we're going to do a podcast about it...
Well, that doesn't matter.
Like, go do it and whatever. So, yeah, well, we're going to do Terminator. I'll just say real quick, I went to Olive Garden for, like, a work lunch thing. Like, just off the cuff, like, hey, we're going to Olive Garden. You going? I'm like, I guess so. I mean, I didn't know we were doing this. The reason why I think it's funny is because you ever go to a restaurant, like an Italian place or Chinese food? You know, you're getting somewhere where it's a specific kind of food. And then you see someone order something with French fries. And you think to yourself, I would rather just eat a hamburger and French fries at an Italian place. Like, you ever feel like a jerk? Do you order, like, American food at, like, an Italian place?
No, I am a person that goes to a restaurant and I go, I don't know, what's good? Just bring that to me.
You sound like that guy. No, what I mean is, like, it's funny, like, you go to a place that serves a specialty of sorts, and then you just get the most non-specialty thing.
No, I am not burdened by being I won't say picky. I am not a fussy eater. Go ahead and continue with your fussy eater story.
Oh, it's just funny because someone that I was there with, they ordered like a meatball sub. You know, it's Italian food.
Yeah.
But it had French fries. And I looked at the
like
French.
On top? Like in the sandwich?
No, just on the side.
Oh, that sounds good though.
It does sound good. But I saw French fries and thought to myself, man, I really just want a hamburger and French fries. I don't want this fucking chicken parmesan. Like, pick chicken parmesan, Olive Garden's great. But I just saw it and was like, I wouldn't mind ordering a hamburger instead. And I just thought that's so stupid.
So you ordered a hamburger?
No, I...
They don't even have a fucking hamburger on their menu,
they
right?
They probably don't, but I saw French fries.
But they have everything they need to probably make a hamburger?
Yeah, well, it's just that you're at an Italian place and you're like, I just want a hamburger. Like, why did you come here?
Yeah.
But it happens sometimes when you go to a restaurant and you go to like, oh, they're going to have like pizza. It's TPK. And then you look at someone else and they're eating ribs. And you're like, or no, I went to TPK one time and ordered salmon.
That's okay.
It's just funny because you should get a pizza if you go to CPK.
No, that's not true. CPK makes, like, you can get, like, jambalaya.
They do, but
like
I always get a pizza. And then one time I went and got salmon, and it was, like, kind of silly. Like, why wouldn't I should go to the fish company if I want salmon.
Yeah, that's true.
Also, fish company.
I that's why I always ask, what is the best here? Because if you're going to go to a place, you might as well get whatever they make the best.
Yeah. Oh, it's a fish market. A fish company.
Yeah.
Clam chowder. Oh, my God. It's so good.
You like clam chowder, huh?
I do now.
You surprise me.
That place is great.
Do you put hot sauce in it, like Tabasco?
I'm not a fucking... I'm not a monster. You know what? The Tabasco, like, debate and, like, people putting, like, hot sauce and shit, I like to actually taste the food. Granted, I put a lot of ketchup on hamburgers.
A little bit of vinegar adds to the clam chowder.
Vinegar is not hot sauce.
No, Tabasco is.
Oh, it's red. Vinegar is white.
I might be wrong on this, but I'm pretty sure one big piece of Tabasco is that it's got a vinegar taste to it.
It might have a vinegar base to it, but I'm saying you just have to, like, throw vinegar in it. Like,
yeah.
That's not the same thing.
No, I do not do that. I go to an Italian place, I order Italian food.
I order Italian food.
I go to a burger place, I order a burger.
Yeah, it's funny. If you see someone else ordering something, you just think to yourself, I kind of want to get, like, it's like a child. You know, you go in a cheeseburger and fries. No matter where they go, it's like every place has cheeseburger and fries.
Yeah,
and you see someone order it and you're like,
it's a fucking waste.
Right, because you could have gone anywhere.
Yeah.
It's just funny because I looked at it and was like, oh, hamburger stuff.
Anytime
really
I'm going to pay for food, I want to take as full advantage of it as humanly possible. That's my thing.
How do you take advantage of food? Do you like caress
when nobody's looking?
Yeah. That's a stupid story. So when I was eating with these people, we'd been out before, like we went to a sushi place before. And I go to sushi all the time, right? I've never been to a place where it's like a buffet sushi because usually buffet sushi sucks.
Yeah.
So I didn't know that some buffet sushis were like, you would order all this stuff, and I'm like, just fucking shovel it in my mouth, right? Give me this, shovel it in. I shove it. I don't fucking care. I love sushi. Well, there's places where if you order too much, you get charged for what you don't finish.
Interesting.
It makes sense, though. If you order 8 rolls and you only eat 3 of them, you're like, well, fuck, it's a buffet. What do I care? And they go, well, and it's like, where are the rules? Like 60% of the plate has to be empty, whatever it is. So I ordered a shit ton of food because we went out as a big group. I was like, I want this. I don't know. We had never been there before.
But if it's a buffet, you're not ordering.
So what it is you order and they bring it to you. They make it's sushi. They have to make it.
All right.
You know, it's not a buffet where you get up and grab it. It's I want this roll. I want this roll. Or I want, you know.
Right. What makes it a – I don't get it.
It's
how's that not different?
$25 unlimited. So it's like a buffet.
I see. So you go $25 unlimited.
Yeah.
So $25, I want this much.
Right.
And then they charge you
for
anything
you don't
eat.
And they have this thing where they come in like 3 waves. It's like the first wave, like, what do you want now? And
right.
You know, they want you to fill up and then I want to order. So I was like, I'll get all the shit now. I don't want to do the waves. I want to order all my food in the beginning and get all of it so I can just shovel it in.
Yeah.
Well, I ordered a lot. I convinced everyone else to order a lot. And then as we're kind of getting to the end, they're like, oh, there's all this extra food left over. I'm like, well, you know, I'll try to take some of it home. They're like, oh, you can't. You have to eat it or they're going to charge you. I went, what? Like, I didn't know this.
I'll get it in to-go box.
But not even to-go. It's just that, like, oh, it was left over. It's a half of this thing or half of that thing. But it's like, if you don't finish it, you have to pay for it. And I went, okay. I was not aware of this. I look at all the food on the table and went, holy shit, there's a lot of food left. And everyone's like, I'm so full. I can maybe try to help finish that and that. And I went, okay, burden's on me. And I can just fucking just start eating and eating. And so.
Yeah, but you could just take a bag when nobody's looking and just go.
Right.
And this would be the end of it.
So normally when I go to sushi, I will get, I mean, depending on which.
Just give me your purse. No, what are you going to do? Just give me your purse.
Just put a lining inside of it and just shove all the food in. So like when I go to like a nice higher end sushi place, God, we sound so fucking douchey white. But we go to Mahi's and like that, we spend like $100 on two people because you order a bunch of weird shit.
Yeah.
When I go to regular sushi, I get like three rolls. And if I get three rolls, I usually get two. If I get three, I'm stuffing myself to get that third one in. Like I'm full. We came away from this place. I think they said I ate like 6.5 rolls of sushi. Just a really dumb amount.
Yeah.
And some of it was big.
Yeah.
Like it was really tall and really thick. I got the like their specialty one that was named after the store. So I told them what my life has always been is that I have this weird fantasy. I think I might have told you this before where I want to be at a restaurant somewhere and eating a bunch of food. And someone looks over and she's like, oh my God, look at him eating all that food. That's amazing. And then like, other, oh, look at him. They're pointing at me and they're going like, wow.
And a slow clap.
No, a fucking camera crew shows up from like the local news. And they're filming going, look at this guy. He just keeps eating. And then like I end up on TV with like an award of just like, kind of like the Man versus Food. When I watched Man versus Food, I was like, that's me. I could do that stuff. Not the spicy shit, but, like, I could eat 10 pounds of meat in 35 minutes or something, you know? So I had this weird thing where, like, when I go out, in the back of my mind, what I want is a camera crew to show up and be impressed by how much I can eat.
Learning so much about you right now.
And I'm not a big fat guy either. I'm not – I mean, I have this weird gut on me, and I don't even drink, but I'm thin. People think I'm skinny, right?
You're tall.
Yeah, but I'm still skinny in terms of – like, I mean, look at my forearm, right? So – yeah, I was Olive Garden and I was shoveling the food in and they all kind of joked about how much sushi I had eaten and like just this, they kind of knew about this dumb like fantasy I have. To go with that, my brother used to work, still does work for the airlines. He got it put in like the airline, you know, like the employee magazine they get. They just like, you work
the one you look at on the plane?
No, you've never worked anywhere that's interesting. Like it's a big enough corporation where like there's like an internal magazine for employees. They would talk about like what the going ons in the company and like, oh, this employee got the medal for this, the award, and employee of the year and shit, like that stuff. He got mentioned in one of those because he won a taco eating contest. He ate like 22 Del Taco tacos.
So it's in your family.
So that's the thing. Is like that kind of came from that. It was like he got to be put in a magazine for like his eating skill. And I was like, I want that,
you just
but
wanna
I want to be on TV.
You want to be in a magazine.
I want to be on TV.
You want to be on TV for eating skill.
Yeah, but I don't want, I'm not like a competitive eater style or anything.
I feel like it's a modest goal. I feel like we could accomplish that.
It's so dumb, but it's this weird thing that would make me so happy.
It's funny thing about modest goals, and like people are like, this is all I would want. This is all I would want, then I could die. And I'm like, some people, every once in a while somebody says something. So I know somebody, maybe he listens to this and it'd be really funny, but I doubt it. There's a guy that I know, and he goes like, I would just want enough money that I could just spend the next like probably like 3 to 5 years reading everything that I want to read and watching all the movies that I have and then getting caught up. And then I just kill myself. And I go,
oh my God.
Or, you know, like that would be it. I would be enough that I could just die. That's what he said. And I go, and I'm like, I sat there in silence for a few seconds and I went like, that's the most like easily accomplished goal that's ever existed. You could take out just like 5 credit cards, take out a loan for the bank, just quit your job, do all those things, get caught up. And then like you're all set. Like everybody else has like a fucking like gnarly dream. Like they want a mansion or I want to go here. Things they never could be able to do. You lucked out. That's a thing that you could totally do. I'll help you do it. That's like I will start this goal for you. I will give you some money.
We'll make it like an internet thing where like this guy's going to recover 3 years and
it's
kill
like
himself.
It's super easy.
Oh my God. Do you realize how much like intervention and money you could raise to like hope you, I'm going to kill myself in 3 years, but first I'm going to do all this stuff.
Yeah.
And they would follow it daily. We should do this. Like anyway. A daily blog post of what he did today and how many days left until he kills himself. Countdown.
He's only got 15 books left.
That's actually really good. But yeah, it's a stupid thing of mine that I
support your goals.
So the last – actually the camera crew thing the eating thing, like that idea of like, oh my God, look at him go. That's actually kind of how you got your nickname. That's how you became the rookie. Or not the rookie, but rookie.
From not Shakey's, Sizzler.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. See, Sizzler's another one of those buffet things where I would eat meatballs.
Or corn nuggets.
And people,
you ate a bunch of corn nuggets because you thought if I eat enough of these corn nuggets, if I ate a giant can of corn, what if my shit was 100% corn?
No, there's a, you know, it's funny you bring that up. Just a couple days ago, I told my wife, I still never did the corn thing where I ate like only corn for a whole day.
Oh, I thought that was like, that was the goal.
I was going to buy like 3 cans of corn
and just eat a ton.
And I never did it. I should still do it. I'm scared what if it like screwed me up now and like I couldn't get the poop out because it was just, it was just a corn on the cob.
Yeah.
It went in as corn in a can and came out as corn on the cob. Like it got put back together. But no, that's how Rookie came about because it was like, I think I was eating a bunch of meatballs and corn nuggets and you're like, oh, I'm full. I'm like, oh, what's the matter, Rookie? You can't eat more. And you're like, oh, I'll fucking show you. Like,
yeah.
But it came from because I was like a competitive eater in a way.
Yeah.
I was like, what, you can't keep up, pussy? Like, why can't you do that? And that's where Rookie came from.
Yeah.
Which I guess is also why I'm the alpha male because look at how I act.
Yeah. Yes.
But yeah, Sizzler, I forgot about that. That was how kind of that happened.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what happened
once. Comfortable amounts of food.
Do you remember when McDonald's used to sell hamburgers for 29 cents on Wednesdays?
Yes.
Yeah, I know, because that's how you lived, actually. I went, and we were like 12, 13 years old this time, probably, like young teenager.
Yeah, I mean, they did it, I know that I was doing it in high school, because I have another story there.
I went to McDonald's with my friend at like an early teenage, you know, we don't have much money, but $3 can buy you a lot of hamburgers. And I would buy like 8 hamburgers. And what I would do is I would take all the patties out, and I would fold the patties up in half, and then fold it in half again, and I would shove the entire McDonald's patty in my mouth. And I would just eat the patty by itself. And it was, it's like, you get the whole, I mean, McDonald's is disgusting. I don't go to McDonald's anymore. Maybe I'm only a teenager or whatever. If you shove enough food in your mouth, you get more flavor. That's just science. It's just the truth. There's no debating that.
If you shove enough food in your mouth, you get more flavor. That's what you said.
Yeah, no, it's supported by science. So I like to take a lot of food sometimes. So, like, if you take a bite of a hamburger, you get this much. If you take the whole patty and you fold it up and you shove it in your mouth, you get all the flavor of the patty at one time, and your taste buds just go joy. So I was doing that, and there was a lady sitting there, and she was like, "Are you gonna eat all those hamburgers?" And I went, "Goddamn right I am!" And I proceeded to eat 8 hamburgers because I would eat the buns afterwards. Like, weirdly enough. I think that's where it started. Someone saw me eating and was really impressed and even asked me what I was like. Then I thought, like, was she homeless with her kid and was asking for the food? Like, I would have given her those buns. I don't know.
That would be the best thing ever if you thought that they were just really impressed with your eating prowess, but really they're just starving.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. But that's probably where that seed was planted, was because of that McDonald's trip.
I just remember when they did stuff like that. Like, Burger King did a similar thing to, like, compete with McDonald's. Like, you'd have, like, 30, 40-cent cheeseburgers or whatever. And I used to work at a skate shop in high school, and we'd make trips over there. And they fucking hated us because we'd just go up and be like, go to the drive thru and go, I'd like $5 for the cheeseburgers. They go, sir, how many cheeseburgers did you like? I'm like, however many $5 gets me. It's like, I'm not gonna like sit here and go like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on the register until it gets over $5.
You know, that still happens. It still happens to me when I go to like In-N-Out and I have to order things that they don't know how to create on the register. Because like, I don't want a 4x4. I don't want cheese. And I know you're like, oh, put cheese on your hamburger. It's not a hamburger. But I don't like Kraft singles. I think that's fake. I want real cheese. So I don't want a 4x4. Plus, if I eat 4 pieces of meat and 4 pieces of cheese on a hamburger, I'm going to fucking die. So I have to get it's called a 4x meat. It's 4 meat patties, onions, spread, lettuce, no tomato. So every time I go there, like the technical term is it's a double, not a double-double, but it's a double meat with 2 extra patties. Versus just a 4x0, which, so you get different employees who go like, they call it a 4x meat, or they call it a double with 2 extra patties, or that a 4x0, or a 4x. But when they go to order it, because like now the In-N-Out over here, they have the people that walk outside to take your order, rather than you pull up to a thing, they have a person with like an iPad, and they're like, and they're looking at you, can tell these like, how do I create a 4-patty burger? What do I push? Like, it's so great because they never know. And I'm sitting there going, so what you want to do is you make get a double and then add a patty. Like, I'm actually showing them how to do their job because I'm fucking stupid and I order big meals and stuff.
They should hire you because there's probably so many people ordering 4x meats that you would be, you know, like an important part of the operation.
Yeah. Call me when you need someone who needs four patties or more. I know what to do. I'll just be sleeping here on the buns until then.
Buns.
I mean, the buns are soft. You can sleep on them.
I haven't been in and out in a million years because I just can't handle the line.
You know what? I want to punch you in the face right now.
Because I can't handle the line?
No, you're, I mean, because you live near the one that's.
Every time I get off work, I get home like at 9 o'clock. And there's an in and out right by my house. And I drive by it. You tell me you want to punch me in the face, but you should feel bad for me. I drive by in and out. Yeah. I've worked all goddamn day. It's late. And I look at it and I go, fuck. It's what, like I'm going to be in line for like 15 minutes before I even can order.
A good in and out trip. A quality, like, that wasn't that long from beginning to end is probably 17 to 18 minutes. That's like a not, that wasn't too long.
No, it'd be longer than that.
See, no, I know. That's what I'm saying. Like, actually, you're right, because I know which one you and that sucks. I have a nice new car finally for the first time in my life. And so, like, on Tuesdays or Wednesdays, the night that I make dinner. So I go to, sometimes I'm just like, fine, I don't make dinner tonight. It's hot. I have to wash the dishes. Like, I don't want to make dinner and wash dishes. I'll just go to In-N-Out on the way home. Bombcast came out on Tuesday. I'll just sit in the drive-thru and listen to the Bombcast in my car.
Yeah.
Makes me happy. Like, it's something I like to do. And so what I've learned is you have to, like, I have to leave work between 4:35 and 4:42. If I leave any later than that, I'm fucked. And I can get to In-N-Out and have only be, like, four cars. And it's the In-N-Out we live near has a double driveway.
You said four cars in the drive-thru?
It has two drive-thrus.
So it's really like two cars in the driveway.
No, it's drive-through. It's eight cars, four in each one.
Oh.
But it's like having one driveway of four.
I'm just saying four cars in the drive-through, I would get in that.
That's what I'm saying. It's not that bad. If you always wait 5 minutes later or 10 minutes later, it's all the way out to the street, and the street's backing up.
Yeah.
So I understand.
Every night I got to go like, oh, In-N-Out sounds good.
You have Tommy's.
So I'll get Tommy's, which will fucking destroy me. Yeah. It will just destroy my insides.
Because I haven't lived down there near Tommy's in a long time. Remember, we used to go.
Tommy's closes earlier than you would think.
Now they used to be open until 3 o'clock in the morning.
Not anymore.
Oh, I remember they beat In-N-Out as far as how late they were open. I remember we knock on your door and like, hey, Ryan,
I've been the last customer at Tommy's like several times.
Yeah, we've done that before. remember we knock at your door? It was like 1:30. We're like, hey, Ryan, we're going to Tommy's. You want to go? And you're like, I was gonna go to bed, but. Yeah, fuck it, why not, you know?
Yeah. To be young.
Do you remember when we went, two things with this one. We went to the liquor store, and we bought those porno mags, and we cut out all the pictures and pasted them all over your room.
Well, you jumped straight to the punchline.
Oh, sorry, I know, I went to Chinatown with my friends, cause I don't know why, we went to Chinatown, and I decided to stop by his fucking street vendor, the magazine vendor on the street, because he had Chinese porno mags, and I went, I should buy one of those. I'm curious what that looks like. And then we cut that one up and said, oh, we should put this on Ryan's walls. And it turns out we didn't have enough porn. So me and my wife went to the liquor store and bought like a cherry, bought another one, and came back and cut that one up and put it all over the walls too.
You're
I don't remember what
you're missing the best part of it, because I went on a trip, and when I came
that's
back.
That's what it was, yeah.
My door was closed, my bedroom door was closed, and you put like a big penis, like you taped it up on like the front of my door. I'm like, oh, ha,
it was
funny,
just a full space spread. We just cut it.
It was just like taped on the front of my front door.
It was a super close up of a vagina.
Okay. Funny guys.
And it was like, what, 12:30 at night? So we were actually in the bedroom.
Yeah.
Like next to, we were like, okay, it's quiet, turn the lights off. We were in bed. And we're like, oh, Ryan's coming home. Okay, let's go to the bedroom and like turn to where sleeping.
I don't remember if I actually reacted or not.
So what we hear is, oh, that's real funny before you go inside, right? And we're like, okay, good. It's like he thinks that's all it is. And then.
Yeah, then I walked in and my entire fucking room is like been wallpapered with not just porn. You got like fat porn and like old people porn and like.
I remember there was like a school bus that was like decaled with like anime porn and one of those. But I just remember, yeah, because you're like out in the hallway. You're like, oh, ha, 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 guys, real funny. And then you open the door and I just hear you just legitimately just start laughing like really hard. And
that's good.
That was part one. Part two was we went to L.A. that one time to CineSpace. To see Grease. I took her. So we don't ever go on dates as a couple. We were like, just, you know, we're together. I was like, I'm going to take you on a date. I'm going to be romantic. I took her to CineSpace to go watch Grease because Grease was one of her favorite movies. And I had never actually watched it. So it's a place where you get dinner and a movie. So you sit down, you order dinner, and then they play Grease with the projector.
Mm.
It was actually really fucking fun. I thought, and the movie was really actually really funny. I liked it a lot. As we're walking back to our car, we walk past a 24-hour porno theater or store. Just, you know, DVDs and shit. I was like, let's just walk in. And, you know, that's the one that has the viewing rooms in the back. that like the bums get like gather up $2 or $3 and pay to go back there. I think you made a thing about like, you know, the guy who has to fucking mop that jizz room up.
Somebody's gotta do it.
Yeah. So anyways, it was like, ugh. But we bought, I was like, let's just buy a fucking DVD just like for the hell of it, right? It's a joke. Because honestly, this stuff is never erotic. It's just always a joke because it's like, who cares? And we saw one that was like 18 hours of content.
I remember that thing.
With a bonus 6 hours to make it a full 24 hours of porn. And I think we said to ourselves, oh, we can't not buy this. This is hilarious. And it was like $20. We bought one. And so what we did is we came home. We put it on. We kind of laughed at it for a little bit. And said, okay, Ryan's getting off work at midnight. He'll be here at like 12:45. Here's what we'll do. We'll leave it on. As he's parking his car, we'll turn all the lights off again, then go to bed. We'll leave the TV on full fucking blast volume.
And our neighbors must have loved us.
Yeah. Did we ever tell you that we could hear the neighbor upstairs fucking?
Yeah, I could hear him too.
Yeah, so fuck them, right? They can listen to it if they want to. And I remember you just coming home and just being like, wow. Like, this is really, really loud. And it's just like full on boom right there as you walk in the door. That was the one with the jewelry store, and he's like, can you check out my watch?
Yeah, I remember.
He's like,
they put it on his dick.
Yeah, so.
Good stuff. We should just describe porn in detail, I think. That should be our next podcast.
Yeah.
Nobody's doing that yet, right? You just watch porn, and you describe it as it's happening.
I don't know. Is that something that people do?
Because I don't know.
That sounds pretty funny.
That sounds like some of the YouTube channels that I watch.
Yeah, no, instead of porn, it's comic books.
Yeah.
I would actually listen to a podcast if all they did was like, we bought a porn DVD and now we're going to describe it in excruciating detail.
Yeah. Excruciating.
I think we have
BDSM porn.
I think we know what other YouTube channel is going to be. So yeah, there's enough of that shit. So let's get down to business.
Let's talk about Seven Samurai, which is a perfect segue from
porn.
Porn. It's exactly the same.
Well, I was in Chinatown, so it's almost close to.
Now who's a bigot?
I know, Japan. If anything, I love Asian culture and cinema way fucking more than you do. I have way more respect for it, and I know the differences between Korean and Japanese and Chinese and all that
shit.
Yeah,
but I fucking started with this shit long before. We're going to tell this story real quick before we talk about this fucking movie.
I think we already did.
Yeah, I guess we did.
You made me watch Shaolin Soccer, and then, yeah, I exploded from there.
Yeah, but I tried to get you to watch Seven Samurai for years.
Oh, I don't know.
I tried to get to watch that movie for so long. I'd be like, so fucking good, so fucking
good.
Shout
out to Rick Myers. Rick Myers from I don't remember
And then like
where.
Everything else, you watched it on your own and thought it was your own idea. And then you came back and you went, hey, it's actually pretty good. Yeah, I know, motherfucker. I've been trying to get you to watch it for fucking years. Anyway, you ready to talk about Seven Samurai?
I am ready to
talk
beginning
about Seven of
Samurai.
This podcast.
We're also going to at some point do some kind of kung fu movie podcast. I don't know what it is, but.
Kung fu video. I want to do it.
Just talk about like 10 best.
I don't know. We'll have to think of something, but we'll do it.
I don't want to do like 10 best kung fu movies.
No, it'll be something. We got to have a theme. It'll be something.
But yeah, I am a huge lover of, and not just
like. Okay.
I scraped the bottom of the barrel when it comes to kung fu movies.
I don't know what like got me into that. I think it was
And Asian cinema in general. I like things like Johnny Toe, like Bullet Ballet. It doesn't have to be kung fu. Not The Godfather, but Election.
Yeah.
Like we actually appreciate Asian cinema. Seven Samurai.
I have a bunch of phone notes that I was taking as I was watching it.
Because I finally told you to do
it. And then eventually I got so like caught up in the movie that I stopped taking phone notes.
That happens to me.
So it's like the first like 25 or 30 minutes of the movie. Probably that's it. But maybe we could start there and then we'll find what we want to talk about.
I'm sure you want to kind of get a little more academic.
No,
like,
not necessarily.
Like I would let you kind of like get into the spiel of just, you know.
No, I didn't want to sit here and give everybody a big history lesson. Other than
okay.
It was 1954. That's it. So
it's Akira Kurosawa.
Akira Kurosawa.
We obviously white person saying that.
Yeah, I don't know. He's like one of several like big Japanese filmmakers at that time, but he's probably the biggest. Okay, he influenced.
Like we talked about, like you have to have at least seen one Kurosawa film in your life.
One of the things is his movies got turned into westerns at least twice, but that's because he watched a lot of westerns growing up.
And before George Lucas sues us. It's Star Wars.
And also Star Wars. So his stuff is awesome enough that it keeps getting repurposed for other genres. However, he watched a shit ton of Western movies. I do mean like cowboy Westerns,
right,
but I mean like Western
Westerns,
films.
Yeah.
Yeah. But like also a lot of cowboy movies. So it makes sense that when he takes the Western influence and makes Japanese films, that they recursively kind of appeal to Western audiences again.
Yeah, I mean, besides character, I mean, it's just the story. It's a really good story.
Yeah. So Seven Samurai gets made and turned into Magnificent Seven and probably a bunch of other stuff. Yojimbo, the bodyguard, gets turned into
the bodyguard with Kevin Costner.
No. it gets turned into A Fistful of Dollars.
Yeah.
Which is the first movie that eventually ends up being The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. It also, there was a movie that not many people saw with Bruce Willis called Last Man Standing that's basically just a direct remake of it. However, the story, so this is exactly what I'm talking about. Yojimbo the Bodyguard is essentially just a samurai version of a book called Red Harvest by Dashiell Hammett. If Dashiell Hammett doesn't mean anything to you, he wrote The Maltese Falcon, which a lot of people have heard of that movie.
Heard of it, but still means nothing to me.
Okay, whatever. Point being, it's like it's an American book. I like Western shit.
Yeah.
I repurpose it into samurai shit. It gets repurposed again into Western shit again.
It's like, that's like the line from Jay and Silent Bob where it's like, we're going to make you eat our shit, then shit out our shit, and make you eat our shit again. Like,
yeah. Anyway, I don't remember when I watched this or what. Like, I'm getting way into movies. Like, when I was, like, ages 16 to 18, and I was getting 6 movies at a time on Netflix.
Yeah, so there was a time when we both worked for the same job, we were doing security, that we were working, like, the late night shift, and we had, like, a portable DVD player. You would just leave it there, and we would share it, and we would just watch movies.
Yeah.
And that's kind of how some of the stuff just, I watched 5 movies this week.
Right. And that's a good way to start, like, get to actually scraping the bottom of the barrel for Asian cinema because there's so much of it. Anyway, Seven Samurai, I think, transcends, like, Japanese cinema or, like, oh, I like samurai movies or whatever. It's literally a movie that everybody should watch.
It is timeless because it doesn't take – it's so not contemporary. It takes place hundreds of years ago.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if you watched it now or 50 years ago because it's still a time – it's a period piece.
Right.
So it's okay.
Yeah, but it's a period piece, and it's a foreign film technically, right? Oh, it's a foreign film. I saw this foreign film, Seven Samurai, but like it doesn't feel super foreign. I don't think there's a lot of stuff where there's too much of a culture gap.
It's one of the things I want to bring up is like some of that acting, some of the like the way the characters. Like, okay, so that scene. Imagine you just some guy in the street just comes up and walks you and just looks you in the face for a while and never says anything and then walks away. Like, stuff like that happens in the movie. You just think, like, that happened in, like, a regular life. That'd be fucking weird. I won't get into more detail about it. And just some, like, the facial expressions.
Well, I mean, okay. Well, it's Japan.
That's what I mean. And then, like, but, just the nobility and the class system. Let me put it this way.
Like, if you watch, like, an Ingmar Bergman film, if you watch, like, The Seventh Seal, fucking Wild Strawberries or some bullshit, like, those are foreign fucking films. Like, Ingmar Bergman's Swedish.
But, or, like, Irreversible.
Yeah. But, I mean, like, you watch it and you go, like, wow, like, this is... There's a reason why Seven Samurai so easily translates to back to Western tropes again. It's because, like, the people in it are human. Like, you still like, relate to them. You like them. Like, you want to see what goes down with their lives. And you like them. They're very likable. So even though there's, like, weird, maybe there are some weird culture gap things, like, there is that. I feel like that's we might as well just get into it. Okay, so I took a phone note about this, I think, somewhere in here. But, like, one of the things that...
let's just set up the movie, then.
For people that haven't seen it. Hopefully you've watched this shit, because, we're going to just talk about it.
We're going to spoil it, but, I mean, you might say, well, I'm never going to get around to watching it. So it's a 3.5-hour...
By the way, we should consider next time, like, watching something that's actually streaming, like, on Netflix or something. Because, like, of all the people that I talked to... Young people, fuck you, young people. I don't care about you. But, like, a lot of young people were like, what's Seven Samurai?
Right.
And like, well, how do? Then the next question was like, well, how do I watch it? I'm like, your library?
Yeah, you actually probably could check it out from a library.
You probably can check it out from a library.
So, 1954, black and white. So Quentin Tarantino got the rights to this movie, right? And
what?
I don't remember the story. I thought Tarantino's the one who helped it get not maybe basically re-releases like a remastered Criterion type stuff.
I didn't know anything about that.
Because you know how he is with stuff like...
Yeah, I know, but I didn't hear about
maybe
that.
Maybe I'm wrong, but I thought he had a big hand in basically getting the negatives and trying to clean it up as much as possible. So this is a thing where you have to think about the real world, logistics. This was made 60 years ago now. Film doesn't, you know, how you store film, you know, how long ago film has been stored properly, things like that. The actual negative has, there's like hairs on the thing, there's like tears, there's burst. You know, the quality is really good, but there's definite things where, like, I think I remember the Blu-ray version, the DVD version, when I first got it years ago, it was like, there are going to be pieces of this movie that, you know, basically look like garbage or look ruined. This, we've done the best we can to clean it up, we cannot perfect this, because your original source has been damaged over time. You know, it's not like, oh, we just digitized it in the 90s and it's still perfect nowadays. We made a Blu-ray release, 1080p. This stuff is literally like, this is the best you can do because it's old. So it's a 3.5 hour black and white movie that has some very minor issues in the screen. And like some of the lighting you can tell is like it's blown out real bad. But it's still beautiful. I love the way the movie looks. So that's what I said, 3.5 hours. When I first watched it, I don't know how many years ago, I said to myself, that was the fastest 3.5 hours of my life. Like, I cannot believe, like, what? It's been 3.5 hours? It is so goddamn compelling. It is so remarkable. And like every, like we always said, every second of that movie matters. Every second your eyes are glued to the screen and you're just thinking like, what's next? What's next? What's next? Like, it does not ever linger at all until, I want to say there's one scene at the end, which I don't care about. But that movie is practical perfection in filmmaking. So that's the setup for what Seven Samurai is. What is the movie about? It's about Seven Samurais.
It's a pretty genius structure for a film, and there's a reason why people keep... Oh, Bug's Life. I forgot about Bug's Life.
Oh, God. Yes, if you've seen Bug's Life, it's that.
And that's this is what Seven Samurai does, is I remember seeing Bug's Life, because that's a Pixar, Pixar movie, right?
Should be. There's ants in that. I think ants was DreamWorks.
Ants is not Pixar. I know that.
Bug's Life is Pixar.
Okay. So I remember being like not that excited about it. Like I was like, oh, it was okay. And then like, I'm like, okay, well,
I really like that movie.
I know, but whatever. It's... Anyway, like years later, I'm like thinking about it. I'm like, and it's not like somebody had to tell me this. Like I had to think about it. I'm like, oh, Bug's Life was a remake of Seven Samurai. I want to watch Bug's Life again. Like,
yeah.
Like making that connection makes me like it even more. But Seven Samurai, it's a pretty basic setup, but it works wonders. It's essentially you have a village of poor farmers that are besieged by bandits in a more lawless time when there's not really anybody out to defend anybody. There's no cops.
Well, since there's been a lot of like feudal territories.
This is Japan. This is feudal Japan. So this is a lot of like small territories going to war with each other.
In late 1700s. No.
I'm bad with the history stuff. I have no
1500s,
idea.
1500s, because there's a part where he has a scroll that says you were born in 1570 something.
That's right.
So it's like the late 1500s.
And anyway, so they don't know what they're going to do. They say, you know what we'll do? We'll go to town. We don't have any money. But there are enough hungry, unemployed samurai, or ronin, at this point.
Yeah, which only one point in that time did he say, I'm like a wandering ronin, but it's called, I mean, they're samurai.
They're samurai.
So it's weird.
Well, I mean, a ronin is just a name for a masterless samurai, which is any samurai that doesn't master is ronin, technically.
Or like you were a samurai for like a castle that fell.
Exactly.
Your master was killed.
Because there's so much war going on that there's a lot of losers, which yes. I want to talk about my phone notes because it's one of my favorite things about the movie. They don't have any money to hire samurai, but they've got food. They're farmers. So we will go to town. We will try to get samurai to come back because they're desperate enough that they have skills because they were in wars. They were employed by regents and castles and all that. They've been in battles and such, but they're hungry. So we'll feed them and we'll hopefully be able to bring some back with us to defend our village against the bandits.
And even with money, it was kind of like, you're bunch of peasant farmers, like even if they pay them, they're not worth it.
Yes, that's a big deal thematically about the whole movie, obviously, is the difference between classes, which I was actually surprised at how much it does, even though Japan's such a different culture. I felt like a lot of it actually did like apply to just kind of society in general.
That's why I said there's a little bit of culture shock there, because like the groveling, the like, We can't mix, you're born into the family. I mean, people understand that, but like, it's just like, it's really played up here and it's really gross in a lot of ways. There's a lot of like not humanity in people. And then you start to like get personalities and they have humanity.
Kurosawa got way into that though. That was like his whole deal. There's a whole thing in Japanese culture. You know, there was a caste system, especially in that time period where, yeah, like you were either royalty or you were a samurai or maybe you worked in a town, like you had a tavern or something, but other than that, you were a peasant.
And
you know?
I mean, and literally the point where like, you're such a piece of shit that if like a samurai wanted to come and just cut your head off for no reason.
Yeah.
Too bad.
Yeah. You weren't part of a country. Like this was a feudal Japan. This was civil wars. Everybody's fighting each other. There's no like, there's no state head looking out for your well-being.
There's a magistrate, but
yeah, but
he's
useless.
Shit.
Yeah. It's a bad time. It's a bad time if you don't know how to fight.
Yeah, I mean, there's even a thing that says, like, the farmer's like, you know, we get shit taken, bandits come and take our stuff, and if we have the nerve to fight back, they kill us.
Yeah.
Like, you know, if we complain to somebody.
Damned if I do, damned if I don't.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it sucks.
So in the very beginning, they're all like, they're crying because the bandits come over the ridge, and they see the town and said, oh, we're going to come back when the barley is ripe. We took all their, the guy goes, we took all their rice. Like, they only have any barley, but the barley's not ready. We'll come back when it's, after they've harvested and everything like that. So there was a guy laying in the grass on the bottom of the ridge right there that overhears them and goes, you know, that makes that clown face and runs back to the village to tell them the bandits are going to be coming back to steal our barley.
So,
and they all freak out.
I want to talk about that really quick because everything you've just described is less than 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I mean, before he goes down and talks to the rest of the village, I had to write down, because the beginning of the movie is, like you said, it's the bandits coming over the ridge and seeing the thing. Technically, before that, there is a few lines of just describing what feudal Japan was like what the setting was.
Like, literally just words on the screen.
But one thing I was actually really impressed with was I watched this with my girlfriend. It was a 3.5-hour movie. She stayed awake. That's a fucking miracle. And it really a testimony to this movie, because I watched an hour and a half movie with her, and it's the middle of the day. She's going to fall asleep. But she stayed awake the entire time. It was impressive. But she was looking down at her phone before the movie proper started, so she missed that beginning, like, explaining what the setting was.
Exposition.
Yet not once during the movie did she, like, wait, I don't get it. Like, why is he doing that, or why are they doing that, like, in terms of the setting? That's how well the story and the world is just conveyed.
So one of the things that Kurosawa does really well, which I think, like, movies don't anymore, like, I made a note about it for later on in the movie, it's just that he conveys a really good sense of space.
Yes.
Like, when they walk around the town, the north, the south, the east, west, and they show it all, you get to see how big the village really is. You get to see where the woods are in relation, where the trails are in relation. You actually understand what you're looking at. He takes time to just kind of go out in the open and just get a nice pan shot of, like, the woods and people walking through the woods.
Well, I think that Kurosawa in general just does a good job. Okay, so it's 3.5 hours. So you would think, like, ugh, no. That's
right.
Like what you were saying. The movie will move. And that is because even though it's 3.5 hours, it's lean. Everything he does is for a purpose, and he tries to get maximum amount of impact out of it, whether that's in a character level or a story level or a setting level. What I want to say is a perfect example of this in the very beginning of the movie is, again, when those bandits come over the ridge and they see the village, five lines of dialogue, might be less, between the bandits, and gives you everything you need to know for the setup. It's literally like less than 30 seconds,
right?
And it sets up the entire fucking movie. The bandits come over the ridge, they go, oh, let's take that village. And one goes, no, wait, we just hit them not that long ago. And the other one goes, we'll come back when the barley is ripe. And then they leave.
Yeah, I just said all that.
That's it.
Yeah, I just said all that.
It's literally like nothing.
Yeah, I just said all that.
Okay, but you didn't. It's literally three lines of dialogue. Yes, and the villager runs down to go talk to the other villagers.
Yes, but yeah, I mean, in talking about the part, like, you know, being 3.5 hours, like, there are scenes when, like I said, like, people are just walking, but everything has a purpose. Every scene of somebody walking or staring at the camera or looking at something, you're getting the sense of, like, who that person is and what it is they're trying to accomplish. And it matters that you're watching them look at this area or look at this mountain. It's weird because it's just really hard to comprehend. How is he able to do it so goddamn well?
Well, it's just
because nobody does this stuff.
It's also the actors in the movie. So everybody, when they talk about Kurosawa, is like, oh, they're sucking his dick all day long. He's such a good film director. But there's really good actors too.
Oh yeah,
and what you're talking about when he'll put the camera on somebody, not show you always, show them kind of like what he's looking at, and then spend a good 15 seconds just watching the actor figure it out in his head.
Yeah,
no dialogue, no like really forced perspective shots where you see what they're looking at. Literally, just see him looking at maybe between two people. And you see it working out, and you see it just in the acting, in the physical acting, in the face. And you go, I get it. He's working it out that this person is related to this person somehow, and he's figuring it out. Or on a strategy level, on a war level, he's looking at something and going, I see what he's doing. He's figuring it out. He's figuring out how to use it to his advantage.
Yeah.
It's as much a credit to the actors as it is the director.
It's the kind of thing, if someone did it now, I feel like they would screw it up, and it would just be kind of like, why was there so much dead space?
Yeah, dead space, exactly. It's not dead space.
Right. There's no dead air, but there is.
It's the whole show don't tell mentality.
This movie makes negative space work for it.
Yes.
So
a perfect example of that, really quick, is I wrote a note down here. This must have been less than 5 minutes in the movie. I just said, fuck poor people, basically. it's really like, it's the worst possible situation ever between starving and dying and being slaughtered.
And there's a whole dialogue, not narration, but there's a whole like speech given about that.
So there's once the villager runs down and says, like, oh, they saw the bandits and heard what they were saying, they're all just out in their, like, the village center, just basically, like, writhing around on the ground and just, like, talking about how fucking this sucks. Like, that's it. Just, like, if we do this, we're fucked. If we do this, we're fucked. Like, one guy's like, why don't we just hang ourselves, you know?
He's like, won't God have any mercy on farmers.
Yeah, exactly. They're scared that if they kill themselves, that the next life is going to suck. What if the next life is worse?
Yeah, the old lady says that. She's like, I want to die a peaceful death.
Such a bummer.
What if my other life after this is just as bad as this life?
It's Kurosawa obviously has like a soft spot for the underdog, the lower class. You feel there's a part later where they spill all their rice. Somebody stole their rice.
Yeah.
And his name is Yohei or Yohai. I'm going to fuck everybody's name up. And he's the most pathetic motherfucker ever existed ever. He's got frowny face all day long. In this first scene where they're talking about, like, well, maybe we should kill ourselves. What do we do? One point, the Rikichi, I think, is the guy who's like full of fire.
He wants
to fight everybody. He's the villager that says, like, we should
fight back.
Let's fight back. Right. And as soon as he says that, this poor guy, Yohai, and it wasn't like, it's not playing for comedy. Like, I felt bad. He's like, I don't think I could do that. Like, he gets really scared, like, the idea of, like, having to fight somebody.
If you think about the old, like, I remember my parents had a ceramic plate. Some dumb shit. But it's a bum with clown makeup.
Yeah,
like an old hobo.
I know what you mean, yeah.
That big red smile around, but he's frowning.
Right.
And it's just super exaggerated.
That's Yohei.
Oh, my God. To a fucking T. His mouth is like a permanent, upside down.
Yeah.
It's horrible. He looks so bad.
He really is, too, because he's played it laugh sometimes at his own expense. But he's also, like, he's sort of the embodiment of, like, the poor farmer. Like, poor fucking guy. He just wants to eat. Like, he just wants to, like, get by.
He's just so depressed. Like, my life, everything goes wrong.
He's so fucked. But, like, he still tries, like, a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
Like, he's, like, a meager. It sucks. Poor Yohei.
So that scene where they're telling him, like, what should we do? Should we fight back? Should we get samurai? And they're like, let's go see the old man up at the mill. And I love it because the whole village just fucking marches up this hill.
Yeah.
They all just go, like, in a big group in a line, just marches up the hill to the old man.
Yeah.
The town elder is just this fucking wrinkled-ass old dude who just sits in a mill all day.
Yeah, and that...
And he's great. That's a great character.
Oh, he's fantastic. He's super old. There's two super old people. There's the super old village elder dude. And there's also just an old lady who, like, her kids have been killed, her husband's been killed, she's the last one left, she's starving, there's nobody to look after her except for, like, the villagers that feel bad for her. Real quick, before we move on to that scene where they're all, like, in a circle talking about what they're going to do.
Basically, there's just a lot of despair.
There's a lot of despair. And, but even though, like, the point of that scene is just, like, wow, everything's fucked... Going back to, again, Kurosawa, like, getting across, like, maximum amount of information with minimal amount of, dialogue or whatever. At one point, there's the whole thing where one person in the group says, he says something like, do you know how low we've had to stoop before when it comes to, like, killing Ronin? It's very briefly mentioned. Like, later it makes sense what they're doing, but they just say something about, like, it's like something we did that was bad, like a level that we had reached before where we were never reaching any lower before. And every single head that's, like, down crying on the ground raises up for a second and then, like, lowers their head again. It's like, what the fuck did they do?
I don't remember this.
It comes up later. It has to do with...
The armor and stuff.
Where they get the armor, where they get the spears.
I don't remember
that
at the beginning, though.
It's telegraphed in the very beginning. It's very subtle, but
I just remember them saying, like, we've had to, like, give up all our food before, like, we could... You know, we can do it again.
There's something where it's just like, we did something really bad. And they're like, what did they do? Did they, like, prostitute out their women? Like, what did they do? Like, there was something horrible. And everybody raises their head. Like, they all know. They all participated in it. But again, little character things, it's just brilliant.
Yeah. Everything about this is great. So basically now they send four guys out to town to try to go hire samurais by promising that we can feed you rice.
Yeah.
And they don't even eat rice anymore because all the rice is gone. They have to eat millet.
Millet must fucking suck.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is. I should have looked it up, but it must be horrible because every time somebody brings up millet to somebody else that doesn't eat millet, they're like, oh, you eat that? It's literally like shit. It's like, well, we're going to eat our own shit. And be like, if you said that to somebody else and be like, that's what you do? That's really what you do? Like, I mean, well, things must be bad, but...
Someone ate it and they were like, oh, I could barely keep it down.
Right. Like, one of the younger samurai later is like, I ate it and I'm sorry because it's really bad. You guys are disgusting.
I thought
really
it was just like gruel or something, but it's probably, it's like bull chips.
I don't know. It must be awful. Whatever it is, it must be terrible.
Yeah. So the four guys go to town, and the weird thing here is that, like, if you approach a samurai, they could just cut your head off if they... Like, the idea is, like, if you disrespect them by saying, I would pay you rice...
Yeah.
You're a dog. What are you doing?
Kurosawa does that right off the bat. The very first, like, encounter with a samurai is... It's the guy who's like really hot and he wants to fight back. He's just like tumbling on the floor. Somebody's pushed him down real hard, knocked him on his ass.
Yeah, right in the middle of like a huge crowd of people.
Right in the middle of the crowd. Like, it's super embarrassing. And he's not like fighting back or anything. He's immediately in a grovel mode. He's scared to death.
Head to the ground completely.
Right. And there's this big ass samurai and he's like, how did you, I can't believe you fucking insulted me. You even had the audacity to dare me to like go do that. What? Who do you think I am? And what it does is like, because all you've seen at this point is you've seen bandits and you've seen poor farmers that all they do is worry, right?
Right.
And then they talk about samurai and then the very first samurai you're like, fuck, they're all going to be like this. Like every samurai is going to be full of pride and not more than full of pride. Like they're going to all be awful. They're all going to be like snooty, like obsessed with class.
I used to be this big, huge thing. Like what makes you think I've dropped below?
Like, even like the movie has to keep going at some point. You expect they're going to get some samurai, but they're going to be awful. They're going to be like, well, I guess I'll lower myself to this station to like do this. You know what I mean? The reason I bring it up is it's amazing contrast. Like they made the samurai an asshole immediately.
Yep.
You hate him immediately. You think Kurosawa probably hates him. Like he hates his heritage. Like he hates the idea that like there was this class system where it's like, oh, you're a samurai. It's, oh, fuck you. Like you thought you're a knight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and we're all peons and peasants and you're a knight. Fuck you. Like that was that's kind of what you get from it a little bit. Like even just from the filmmaker's point of view.
Yeah. They basically get depressed and they're like staying at an inn, but it almost feels like a barn. So, and there's these other guys. Who are those? Why are these other guys?
So you get another group of people, right?
The fucking unibrow guy.
He's the bum. These are the bums. Like,
this is how bad it is. The bums are making fun of the farmers.
Right.
That's how low farmers are. They're below hobos.
Because they at least have like a, I guess like the way they look at it is they at least have a choice in the matter.
But they said they were like gambling and stuff like that. So they,
right.
I mean, they have some money.
They're basically like, I had sex with a rat. So that's got to be better than what you guys are going through.
Yeah.
Like, it's really, they're probably just as gross, but you know, because they're not beholden to anybody or any like even system. Like
speaking of gross, it's one of the things I love about like old timey movies like this. Everyone is so goddamn grimy.
Yeah.
Like if you think about Kikuchiro,
yeah,
he's like scratching himself like a fucking dog, and like just and he's like scratching his chest and his neck and shit. And it's like, dude, why is everyone so gross? Well, but it's, you know,
as soon as somebody takes off their kimono and you see that kind of like G-string like fucking loincloth thing that they're all wearing, you're like, it's like riding up their ass. You're like, that thing must smell like fucking shit. It must be fucking horrible.
Literally,
yeah, literally, it's just up their fucking ass cheeks all day long. That must be awful.
But yeah, the guys in the like these dirty like. They're just, he's got it's obviously like a joke unibrow, but it's like the world's worst unibrow.
Right.
And a dirty beard.
And his beard looks stuck on. It looks glued on rather than grown. Okay, so you were mentioning a sense of space with Kurosawa in terms of like you understand where you're at.
Yeah.
I think that's like an amazing use of close-up and perspective shots, like big wide shots. Because like he uses close-ups like crazy, like big composition where like—
It's literally just the face.
Yeah, that elder, when they go talk to the elder in the village—
It's just his shot of just literally the elder's face.
It's just his profile of his face is taking up half the frame. Like, just, like, his nose is the middle of the frame,
yeah.
And the rest of the shot is the side of his face. But what's amazing about him is that then the whole other part of the frame is a guy in the background, and you're just watching his reactions to what this guy's saying on screen.
Yeah, yeah. Manzo, the old guy?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Who's the one with the big
Manzo? Manzo's the one with the daughter.
The daughter. Who's the one with the big frowny face?
That's Yohei.
Okay, it's Yohei in the background, I think.
Yeah, and you're just watching him like, oh God, like he gets like really worried. But this is the kind of stuff like I'm not a film student. I'm not like
you did take film. You were a film
a little
major,
bit, not really. I took some classes, but it's
and you're
the
like,
kind of stuff
fuck
that,
these people and you left. Little,
yeah, fuck that. They're horrible. Fuck film majors, the worst. But it's the kind of stuff like you can geek out on. You actually look at it if you want to appreciate composition and the way that actually somebody puts actors in a frame and like this is where the frame is going to begin and end. Watch some Kurosawa because. Like that guy, like he made it simple. Like it's the kind of stuff like you watch movies now and you don't want to put the close up on somebody because you're like, that's just too close to his face. That'd be weird and uncomfortable. It's like, no, do it.
Yeah.
Like, because it's interesting to look at.
It's one of those things where you don't need a book or a learning to just like, you just watch and go like, damn, I wouldn't have thought of that. But you look at it and go like, it's definitely an evoking emotion out of me.
Yeah.
He did it right. And it's one of those things where I don't know if he had to think about it or he just understands.
Or just he understands. Yeah. But again, back to the space thing. Then he pulls the camera way back and you see like 50 actors in a frame and you understand, you get it. Like, okay, this is where we are. Even just within this like small area, this town, like I understand where I'm at and what's going on.
I mean, even the first shot of the bandits on the ridge, you see there's the village.
Right.
There's the fields. there's the mountain, here's another ridge. Like, you can, how do I get there, from which direction? You already have a whole lay of the land in the first 30 seconds of the movie.
Yeah.
And a scale of how big and how, like, wide the area can and will be later on.
But also, time. I was really impressed with how he was able to telegraph how much time had passed.
Yeah.
Because they don't spend just one day in this town. They spend, like, multiple days there.
At one point, they said, we've been here for 10 days already.
Right.
And it feels like they're there for, like, 3 weeks.
And it's simple things, like these guys, like these assholes, like these bums that are hanging out in the same, like, stable or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, they'd say things like, oh, it's been 3 days and you haven't found a single samurai. Better go home. Like, yeah. it's little things like that that really,
well,
like...
There's a scene when they're in there that I take a note of. It's just... They've kind of talked to a few of them and been told no.
Yeah.
What's the word for
rejected.
That?
Rejected.
They've been rejected, and they're just feeling bummed. I mean, besides Yohei, who's just like, you know, he's not bummed. He looks like he's on the verge of being murdered.
Just, he's having a nervous breakdown.
Every minute of the day.
Yeah.
But the other ones, they're just in the corner. And I guess people sleep sitting up in this world.
Yeah.
Like, they just sit upright and fall asleep. They're just up on the, you know, their butt with their knees up to their chest, up in the corner against the wall, and they just look so bummed out.
Yeah.
Just so bummed out. And it's just like, oh my God, it's like hurts your heart. It was just so soul crushing.
Dude, like when they had a thing of rice that they've been like, Yohei's job is to protect the rice, and he falls asleep with his arms around the jar of rice.
Yeah, he's like, that's slept with it, my arms online.
What else do you want me to do? Like, I'm fucking holding on to it. I'm so tired that I didn't wake up when the person stole the rice. But there's little rice.
No,
grains.
Rikichi comes in and gets mad and like pushes him and is like, God damn you, look what you did. And he kind of like hits him and you see rice flying through the air as he's kind of pushing him.
Yeah.
Because it's like there's a little bit left,
right.
But not much.
But it's Yohei just like, I don't know, I fucked up, I'm sorry. And he starts picking up.
Well, before he goes, the other guy goes, I'm going to go back to town and get more rice.
That's right.
And he goes, well, what are we don't have enough rice to survive right now.
Yeah, I'll literally die.
Yeah.
I will literally die. Yeah. If you leave, I seriously have no choice.
And we don't have enough to all get back. So yeah, I'm going to die. And then...
Yohei starts just picking up the grains of rice off the floor.
Yeah.
There's like maybe 50, maybe 100. Like, but they're all over the fucking ground. If you and me, if that's something happened, you'd be like, God damn it. You would broom it up. You'd throw it all in the trash can. Like,
yeah.
But this guy, he starts picking up one by one. That's a moment where I almost cried. Like, I was like, that... just fucking sucks. They're so poor. They're so poor. And this is all really important, like setting up this poorness, because like it's going to be...
Poorness?
Poorness.
Poor.
Poorness.
P-O-O-R-N-E-S.
Quality of being poor.
It always goes back to porn.
Because that's what's going to happen. There's going to be a chain reaction of samurai, but it's going to begin with somebody actually having heart. It's going to begin with somebody seeing their situation and go, yeah, that's fucked. Like, I've had hard times, but this is literally the worst I've ever seen.
But it's also just one of those things where, like, people have to have personality. Like, there has to be heart in some of these people. It's just empathy and, like, just understanding the world rather than just being a, like, I was born in this class, I'm a fucking asshole, versus, like, well, I still, you know, I was born in this class, but I still have a heart. You know, I'm still a human being. But a lot of them are, they're just like, no, man, you're just a jerk.
Yeah.
But some of them are like, nah, man, they're cool people inside. They have an air of nobility, but they're actually cool underneath. Which brings the scene where the thief was confronted by a bunch of villagers, or not villagers, but people in the town, and he kidnaps a small child and runs into a building and says, leave me alone.
It's a hostage situation.
It's a hostage situation. And they go, the people in the town somehow grab a samurai and convince him to help.
Kambei. And he is the Japanese Morgan Freeman.
He's so cool. I love the way he looks.
Next time, like, you're not like...
Is he in other movies? Because I want to watch him.
Yeah, he's in Godzilla. Gojira, whatever.
It's like a Mexican J. It's Gojira, I thought.
Gojira.
But it's spelled with a J, but I think it's Gojira.
I don't know. Anyway, he's in it.
If it's Gojira, I'm awesome, and you're not. He is such... So we talk about, like, you know, doing a podcast and, like, our voices are just boring. Like, we don't have, like, cool actor-y voices. This is the equivalent of a person you just look at and go, like, he just has a quality.
Oh, he's amazing. I mean, all the actors are amazing, but, like, there's a reason why he's the leader.
Oh, but, I mean, just you look at him and just, like, I want to hang out with that guy.
So he's got, like, a top knot thing, which is a lot of samurai have. They have longer hair. It's tied up top.
Almost everyone does, though.
Yeah, but the villagers have their head shaved.
No, the samurais have their heads shaved in the middle.
Villagers have their heads shaved.
New. So Gorobei and like
But they still have their hair long. Okay, fair enough. Whatever.
It, that's why I said I don't know enough about that culture to know why some do and some don't.
In any case, he's got some hair.
He cuts it. It's almost like a ponytail, and he decides to just cut off the ponytail in one big chunk.
The reason why he does that is because he's...
And he starts to shave his head. I make a note about this. He pulls a guy over, and he goes to a river and just, you know, gets water out of the river. It must be fucking freezing. And, you know, kind of gets himself wet. And then he gives a guy a razor and has him shave, you know, the hair.
Yeah.
He shaves down. Like, that's the kind of razor, like, you think, oh, I'm going to get a hot lather and shave you, which kind of shave upwards. Mm. I watch it, and he's, like, shaving down the face. And I went, oh, my God. That made me twinge. Like, that was just weird. I've never seen it.
He's just cutting the hair off. He's not really.
I know, but it's just the way he did it was just like, oh, if someone took a razor, like, that feels like you would go this way, not that way.
Yeah.
That's how much of a badass he is.
But the reason why he's doing it.
He's gonna portray being a monk.
Yeah, he's gonna pretend he's a monk so he can get close to this thief that's got the child hostage. Now you don't know anything about Kanbei, like as an audience, like you're watching this and you're like, okay.
So
he looks old. And
here's what Kurosawa does so well: you as the viewer are watching the movie,
yeah,
and you're with these four guys from the town. They feel like they're they don't know where. I mean, they're in a town, but they feel out of place.
Yeah,
they don't know what's going on. They're also kind of confused and stuff. You just see a crowd of people following a guy. And they kind of go, ooh, what's going on? And they run and follow and kind of, ooh, yeah. They're watching from across the stream.
What's the commotion?
The camera kind of, you kind of become one of these, like, I don't know what's happening, so I'm a gawker.
Right,
onlooking.
Yeah.
No one's explaining anything.
Yeah.
The camera and the people as well, you're just watching this thing unfold, and you're going like, ooh, what's going on? And I agree, it doesn't telegraph anything. You're learning, or you're experiencing the same thing at the same time as the characters are.
Right.
Which is another great use of just like you're intrigued, you're like what's going on?
I think the only thing that comes across from Kanbei when you first see him is that he's not necessarily super imposing. Like he's an older guy, short.
Yeah.
Like he's not like if Arnold Schwarzenegger walked up, you'd be like,
it's always Schwarzenegger with you.
Well, he's the fucking fucking Sylvester Stallone, like. You know, cut my hair off.
Sylvester Stallone just walking around 1500 is Japan.
You know what I mean?
What are you guys doing?
You know, it was another movie. Like, you wouldn't.
I know what you mean.
You wouldn't buy him as somebody like. You would just be like, shit, this guy's he's gonna fuck somebody up. But it's this guy. You're like, I don't know. I don't know what's going on. So his whole thing is, I'm gonna pretend to be a monk. I'm gonna take two rice balls up to his hut.
The child's hungry. You're hungry.
Right.
Just have some food.
And you get this element of Kanbei that it's weird because he's being manipulative.
He's being a master tactician.
He's being a master tactician, which is he's planning, but it's also like his sort of like soft quality to him.
Because no one's paying him to do this.
But everybody, he's like that through the whole movie for the most part. Like you're seeing this element of him, like, oh man, like he's really like soft spoken. He's measured words when he speaks. He's calming this thief. You can tell he does this like he's done this his whole life. He continued to do this, and then of course what he does is he fucking is just really fast, runs in the thing, gets the kid. And all you see, it's an amazing shot because you don't ever see this thief and the kid in the inside of the hut. You just see him from the outside. You just see him run in and then a slow motion shot of this thief staggering out. And you're like, what the fuck is wrong with him? And he like gets up on his tippy toes.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Like he's in pain and then falls flat on his face. And then you see Kanbei walk out with the kid and a sword in his hand that he didn't walk in with. It must have been the sword that the thief had with him. And you go, wow.
Oh. Well, I see. I just figured
it wasn't with him because he was being a monk.
I guess.
You think he was like hiding it under his
yeah,
clothes or something?
Yeah, that's what I took out of it. I figured it was his because
I think he stole the fucking thing.
That was
thing
a nice sword. I mean, it wasn't like a blade. It was a sword.
This is one thing amazing about this movie is that you can fill in your own blanks, I guess. For me, I like the idea that he stole the sword from the guy.
Yeah. Basically, he was really fast, came in and handled the situation.
And fucked him up. And you're like, oh, shit. Okay. Like, so he's really good. So here's everything that has been telegraphed for this guy before we even have our villagers go talk to him. He's talented. He's a tactician. He's smart. He's intelligent. He's quick. He's a warrior. He also has a heart.
Heart, yeah. Okay, all the while this is happening, Kikuchiro, is this grimy ass dude with a big ass, just a big ass
sword.
So
fucking sorry. This is my giant cock sword. Yeah. That's what it is. He's fucking Cloud from Final Fantasy VII.
Absolutely. That sword is probably like 5 feet long.
It's so goddamn big. And the way he carries it, it's always around his shoulder and he's got like a string and he's high. I fucking love it. And the very first shot of him, at least what I wrote down anyway, is like he's kind of with the rest of this audience and he sees Kanbei like doing stuff and he's like amused by it. And he turns around to the two guys, and he, like, flashes his teeth like a dog. Like that.
Yeah.
And they fucking, they bounce away from it, and he, like, laughs and scratches himself. And he's like, he's a fucking dog.
Yeah.
Like, it's exact. He is a stray dog personified.
But he's really intrigued by what's going on, and he, like,
curious.
He pulls up a little thing, a seat, and, then after the guy gets killed and he's laying on the tree, he runs up to him and is just like, ah, ha, ha, yeah. You know, like, why are you here? Like, and then, so to keep moving forward, as Kame's walking away, some young kid that was born into a samurai world, take me as your disciple, and he goes, I'm just an old ronin.
Yeah.
Like, I've seen my share of battle. I can't have a disciple. I don't want anything to do with you. Like, just let me be. I'm gone and bye.
So you've got three characters now. You've got Kanbei, you've got a leader who's a master tactician. He's been doing this a long time. He's older. You got Kukichiro. Kukichiro?
It's K-I-K-U-C-H-I-Y-O.
Kukichiro.
Chiyo.
Kukichiro.
It's Y-O.
Who is like, if he's a samurai, he's a fucking beat-ass samurai. But he's got a lot of energy. He's sort of like the clown.
Yeah, Chiyo.
And then you've got Katsuhiro, I think? Katsuhiro?
Yeah, that's pretty close.
Who is very young. Actor is probably, like, you know, in his 20s or something like that, but I feel like he's portraying somebody who's, like, 16.
He's, like, 17. He's, like, he's a 17. Year away from being, like, an adult, it feels like.
And so you got these three characters. So you got the Kukichiro, who's like super intrigued by, just very curious, almost like a dog or a monkey or a cat or something like that. Just
because,
really,
like I said,
things.
So about being weird is that, like, as he's walking now, as Kanbei's walking away, and the guy's going, "Let me be your disciple."
Yeah,
he just comes up, and pushes him out of the way, and just like gets right in Kanbei's face, just looks at him.
Yeah.
Just, and he's like, what do you want? He doesn't say anything.
He's just like, you intrigue me. I don't know. I have ADD, and right now you have my attention. Yeah. Like, that's.
And I'm like 2 inches from your face. I'm just looking at you, and I'm not growling. I'm observing you.
Yeah.
And then, of course, the young kid kind of puts you to insolence.
Yeah.
And he's like, ah.
Yeah.
And so the combat sees walking away. He's like, no, please take me as your disciple. And so then Kukichiro comes back in again and just like, and just looks at him. And then he puts his arm around the younger kid and says, like, kind of walk with me, ignore this weird dude.
Right, right. Well, that's why he questions, like, are you really a samurai? And she's like, fuck you, I'm a samurai.
No,
look
I
at
don't,
my big-ass sword.
I think it's later that he does that.
Well, he keeps trying to prove it. But, like, he gets pissed because maybe he takes the rock up and throws in the river.
There's a part where he goes, like, are you a samurai? And, yeah, he gets, like, all, like, well, how dare you ask me if I'm a samurai? Of course I'm a samurai. Yeah. Dude, look at this big,
look at my big
cock.
Sword. Yeah. He, like, has a great stance where he puts his leg out forward and straightens his legs. And it's pretty great.
That character is, it's funny because it's a lot of comic relief in this movie too, but he's such a, at first you're like, he's just a grimy, dirty whatever, but turns out he's actually really fucking cool.
That's Toshiro Mifune. Like, he is like the movie star. Like, he's like, I mean, from what I understand, like, Japanese.
Wait,
fucking,
that's Mifune?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I mean,
he's the star of Yojimbo the Bodyguard and Sanjuro and
I haven't watched this in a while, so I'm gonna watch this now.
I mean, he's big. He's like big fucking Japanese movie star. So the villagers run up to Kanbei. They get hooked up with Kanbei. And here's my question for you real quick. Why do you think Kanbei actually helps the villagers? Do you think it's just a simple, like, I feel bad for you guys?
He mentions he has like gray hair.
Yeah.
He's seen a share of battle. You know, he's one of those things, like, he's honest about, like, fighting isn't fun.
Mm.
Like, this is just part of my life. I would like to do something noble, I guess.
I think he wants to die honorably.
Well, I think they all do, but
That's
part of them, is like dying honorably in battle. But I don't know if he needs money. I don't know if he just looks at it as something like, I could do this. These people need my help. Obviously, like I said, he has a heart.
Yeah.
And, like, what else is he going to do right now?
Yeah.
He's old. This is probably a good last, like, hurrah for him.
To me, this is, like, the pure example of what Kurosawa Samurai is. It's more like the knight. It's the superhero. It's the idea that I have these skills. I can help people. And I'm just going to...
I can't remember the exact scene. Like, when he okays it. I don't remember. So, but he asks a lot of information. He's like, well, what would it this? What would that? Before he finally says it, there's something that happens. And I want to say it's the young kid, or Kikichiro comes in and says something stupid. So he kind of just goes like, yeah, I'll do it. I don't remember exactly what it is.
Yeah, I don't remember. Oh, you know what it was? Is he was considering it, but he didn't think it was possible. He was like being logical. He was like, I just don't think you can actually defend this village.
Like, I'll entertain your idea. Give me some info about this.
What happened was that gross, like, impish, like, beard pasted on my face guy went into a whole spiel about, like, how actually fucking poor they were. Like, and you don't know because you're a samurai. Like, you think you've had it bad. You have no idea how bad these guys have it.
Yeah.
And then he's like, shit, all right, fuck it, all right, I'll do it. Like, let's
but
do
he,
it.
He also, like, just thinks, like, we would need 7, right?
And oh, I love that fucking scene. He asks, like, how many questions, and then he just knows, like, we're going to need 7.
And the thing is, what made him say yes was that the guys were like, we can do that. We can get seven of you guys. So he was like their heart and their determination. There's something he liked,
right.
The fire in there that he said, okay.
I love that also the campaign knows that like trustworthy samurai are going to be like hard to find. Like he knows what the audience knows, which we've seen so far. It's like samurais are fucking assholes. Like it's going to be hard to find like seven ones that are going to be like actually okay to work with.
Right. And that are good at what they do.
So we got to talk about real quick. Like the way that he finds out whether people are going to be.
Those three grimy dudes. There's that scene where like there's an old samurai there. Then they go, why don't you hire that fucking guy? Yeah. We beat him up because he was gambling. And he's all drunk and shit. And the guy goes, oh, you want to fight? And they wake up the fat guy. He's like, what? And he just runs out. He wakes up with like his fist ready to fight in the wrong direction.
I remember that.
It's just like a little comic relief. But it just, again, it juxtaposes. Here's an old samurai.
Right.
This guy's a piece of garbage.
Right.
This is what you would have. This is what you would get, you know?
Yeah.
Anyways.
So the way that they test the samurai, just real quick.
Yeah.
Because it's pretty great. So
it makes sense.
Kanbei sits in the middle of this little like barn or whatever, and he has the farmers bring in a new thing, and then they walk through the archway, and he's got the young guy. He's got Katsuhiro, whatever, with a big stick. And he says, stand out here by the doorway, and as they come in, just try to hit him as hard as you can. Because if they're a real samurai, they're going to see it coming. Now, this is an amazing device because it shows you who sucks, who gets pissed, who actually like is like legitimately skilled and can defend against it. But my favorite one is Gorobei.
The guy who doesn't even walk in.
He's the gentle giant. He's the giant fucking samurai. And he stopped. Well, he calls him. He makes a joke about how big he is before he joins
the
group.
He's like a chubby guy.
I don't think he's that big either, but he makes a joke about it. He stops short. He looks inside.
I'm curious what the subtitles say because some of the subtitles in this, you could tell it was like translated to an English. Like it's like, sometimes it, you slut.
He said, what are you playing at? He's like, what's the joke here?
So that's what's funny. My subtitle.
He was tickled by it.
My subtitle said he walks into the doorway. He stops about 3 feet short as he's walking in, and he kind of looks and goes, "You jest."
Yeah, you jest. Yeah.
And I remember that those exact words. He's you're playing with me.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
Right. And that was amazing. And that's what made me like him a lot. He's tickled by everything. He's a guy that like. He right before then he stopped. There's like a group of kids that are singing and dancing, and he kind of stops, just like, oh, I this makes me happy. Like,
yeah.
He's a guy that like he'll stop and smell the flowers.
Absolutely.
And he joins. So that's why I like asking why everybody's joining. Like he joins. He says something to the fact like, I want to make good friends. He says, I want to do this. Like I'm interested in helping the villagers, but you, Kanbei, you interest me.
Yeah. He basically like you find good friends in the strangest places.
Yeah. Which is like, this is great. Like, these are great characters.
The other one that joins is actually one of Kanbei's old friends that he runs into. And it's like, oh, you didn't die here. And he was the one that like, I was laying in the moat.
Right.
Till the sun went down. The castle was burning. It fell all over me. I thought I was going to die. He's like, what did you think about when you're going to die? He's like, nothing. What did you think about it? He's just like, I don't think I thought of anything. I just got out of, you know, and then he didn't say anything else.
So that's one theme that I loved about these guys. These samurais they're losers. And I don't mean that in like, oh, you guys are fucking losers.
Well, some of them admit that they like, they would run in battle.
Yeah.
Because they're smart. They know it's better to be alive than to go out, you know,
and that's
whatever.
What made them amazing. That's what made them amazing characters. That they've seen all this stuff. They've had so many experiences, but they don't have the ego enough to like just die in battle. They know when to retreat and... It's a theme like we lost again, like, you know, kind of thing, but they're still alive.
So the next one, they hear one of the guys is getting food, and the guy goes, ah, there's a little samurai out back, like, who had no money, who wanted me to give him free food. And he said, like, you know, I'm not gonna give you free food. So he was out back chopping wood for me.
Yeah.
And so immediately you go, okay, hungry samurai who's willing to work for food.
Right.
He goes, let me go find this guy. And he's chopping wood. Every time he chops it with ass, he goes, hi.
Yeah.
And he goes, like, why? And then so he's watching, and the guy's like, have you never seen a man chop wood before?
Yeah.
He goes, I like your style.
Yeah.
He's like, I like how you're doing it, you know?
And then, of course, that's Gorobei that finds him. Because this guy, I forgot his fucking name. So
he says the guy likes to laugh a lot.
He's
cracks
great
a lot of
because
jokes.
It's like, he says that he's not the best warrior.
Oh, he says
he's not going to be the most amazing swordsman, but.
Kanbei asks him, how is his sword skill? He goes, barely mediocre.
Yeah. But he says he's honest, and he's got a good sense of humor.
No.
Like, or something like that.
No. Is that the guy that has a sense of humor, the guy that's chopping wood?
Yeah.
Yeah. He goes, he'll be reliable in a hot, like a hot time.
Basically, we're going to need him to like keep everybody's spirits up.
But like, he also mentions like during a, like when something bad goes down,
yeah.
He'll be a very reliable person.
Yeah. I love this like sense of like, especially going back to like the strategy, like, we're going to need 7 samurai. There's like all these things about battle that you don't think about. They're like, it's not just about who's got more swords or guns or whatever. Like, it's so many other things. And one of them is morale. Like, one of those things that's very important is like, have somebody in your team that is going to have a emotional function. He's going to have a function when it comes to morale, when it's going to not just necessarily to kick everybody's ass.
They're getting the gang back together. And the last one, of course, there just happens to be walking by, and there's like a pretend sword battle. It was a duel, but it was with sticks, not with swords. Yeah. And he goes, "Ha, it was a draw." And he goes, "Right, no, I would have killed you." And he goes, "What?" He pulls a sword on him. The guy goes, "Are you? You don't want to die like this."
Yeah.
And then he takes a sword out and he just fucking kills the guy. And so Kame says, "That guy was really good." And they go, "Whoa, whatever." He goes, "No, no." He's like, "I saw him cut a man down with my own eyes.
Yeah,
he's worth it. I don't think he'll join us. He's too good."
Right.
"I let him know where we're staying."
Right.
And then he shows up later and he's outside. He kind of hears them talking, I think.
Yeah.
And I think what he overhears makes him kind of go like, yeah.
So it's...
Is that when... I don't know if it's before or after.
No, that's when Kikuchiro comes in drunk.
And so he goes, "Oh, there's one more samurai."
Yeah.
But he's really drunk. And it's the guy with the eyebrows. At this point, now the bums are like, "Hey, I found you guys one. He's like kind of on board with it. And he goes, "I found you one." And he goes, "He's really drunk." And Kame's like, "If he's a real samurai, he wouldn't get drunk like that.
He wouldn't get so drunk that we wouldn't be able to hit him in the head with a stick."
Right. He wouldn't let his skills...
So they totally hit him in the head with a fucking stick. And he comes in with a scroll that says, "Look, I'm a samurai. Here I am down at the bottom." And he reads it and he says, the way the years work out, he says, like, "If this is true, you would be 15 years old.
13.
13 years old."
He's like, "You look pretty old for a 13-year-old.
Right. Yeah. But it's still, he goes into a big thing about like...
But I mean, that's after they take his sword away and they make him... He chases the people with the swords and they just make fun of him and laugh at him until he passes out.
Right.
But no, what I was going to say was that it's either before the other guy, the skilled guy joins, or after. He gives a big speech about farmers.
Yeah.
And how, like, what do you expect of them? Or maybe that's later on he does that. That's what he does when he gets the armor.
That's the armor speech, which is cool. No, it is another moment of like sympathy where he goes like, "Okay, I'm going to do this." But
that's where the skilled guy joins.
But really, he's doing it for like, "I want to train my..." That guy, like, what Kanbei says about him is that he's really intrigued
by those guys.
He's like, but also like Kanbei says about him, he's like, "This is a guy that wants to test a sword skill. Like, it's incredible. Like the rest of them, I mean, like, I'm good with a sword, but this guy literally is spending every waking moment like, can I be a better swordsman?"
You're talking about the stone face guy.
So you have like guys that join for different reasons. Like, "I want to make friends. I'm intrigued by you. Yeah. Like, I want to die an honorable death. Like, I want to learn how to be a samurai." This guy's like, "This is another test of my sword. This is another thing where I can go do." And
he's
like,
looking for another challenge.
He's looking for another challenge. It's just another fucking archetype. We've seen it in 10 million movies now, but like, how many times did you see it before this? Anyway.
Yeah. And then, so they go, "There's 6 of us." And he goes, "We don't have time to get a 7th one. We'll have to make do."
Right.
And as they're walking back, Kiku's just following them from behind, and like, they'll stop. And they'll look back at him, and he'll stop and sit on the side of the road, and he pretends to, like, throw a rock at him. Like, it's basically a stray dog's following
you. He's literally a stray dog following you home, yes.
And then, but here's the thing. He's got this charm about him where they keep going. At one point, they're eating lunch on a waterfall, and down at the bottom of the waterfall, he's down there taking his clothes off, jumps in the water, and catches a fish with his bare hands. And they're like, "Woo, good job." Yeah. Like,
I mean, it's the first sign that's like, oh, he's not actually just a bumbling idiot. Like, as far as we know, like, all he does is get drunk.
And he's got a lot of heart. And he's a big, tough-looking guy.
Right.
He probably could be pretty good, but he's just hot-headed and crazy.
Right. But seem to go in there and just, like, grab that fish bare hand. You're like, okay, he knows how to do something.
Right.
He may know how to do something else. Okay.
And then, of course, and they're still walking. And then at one point, they're like, "Oh, where'd the stray dog go?" And this is the funny guy. Yeah. He's like...
Hayahachi. Yeah. His name is Hayahachi.
Hayahachi, yeah. He's like, "I kind of miss him now that he's gone." And then all of a sudden, he pops up in the front of the group from above. He just jumps down from a thing. Always laughing. He goes like, "You know, it's this way, you morons."
Yeah.
And they're like, "Yeah." And I think he basically the equivalent of like, "Should have said anything," or like, "You know, I should think before I talk," because now he's back again and I don't actually want him here.
Okay. This movie's really fucking long, and we're gonna move along a little
bit. We're gonna truncate the whole middle of the
movie. Yeah, because like, there's so many small subplots. Like, they get to town, and like, they hide their women because they're scared of them. They gotta figure out how to get them out. Like, there's 10 million different subplots.
Yeah.
There's a small romance subplot between the young samurai and one of the daughters of the village.
But is it Monzo, the one with the daughter?
Monzo's the one with the daughter.
He cuts his daughter's hair off.
Because he's scared that the samurais are gonna rape his
daughter. And he tells her to like, look like a boy and pretend you're a boy. Yeah, shit like that.
I don't know. What's the next scene that like struck
Basically, they like get us a map. They start looking at the defenses. They're going, here's like, what road would you come in if you were attacking?
Right.
We come from this way. And they survey. And it's a long time where they survey the land for a while and come up with ideas. Build a fence, flood the field.
Right.
And this is where I talk about like, a lot of dead air and dead space. It's just them walking around the village
right.
and pointing at the map and going like, let's walk over here and see what this looks like. And yeah. it's cool because I'm learning everything about the village.
Yeah.
It's a video game.
Yeah.
You're exploring the map until you know every nook and cranny.
Right.
You know?
And they started training the villagers as well.
So because... one of the things I didn't take notes of, but also I got a weird, really weird sense of Rashomon when the girl and the young kid are out in the field.
Yeah.
It looked a lot like Rashomon did.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's out in the trees. He was known to use natural light, point the camera up at the trees, like, oh, lay down in the grass and watch the wind flow through the
plants.
And you
get a sense of, like, the younger one is, like, he's picking flowers and
he's such a little boy.
He sees the girl, but he thinks it's a boy.
Right.
And he goes, what are you doing out here picking flowers? Like, you should be a man. And yet he's pointing at, and he points at her.
And he has the flowers
and he goes, oh, God damn it. Like,
I mean, also, like, at one point, they're down and then she, like, flops down. She's basically, like, giving him fuck me eyes.
No, because so they wrestle. He chases her down, thinking it's a guy. And he's like, I'm going to take you back. And then he's like on top of her, and I think he feels her breast.
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, God.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't realize what this was. And then they kind of talk, and she says, like, like you said, basically, like, stop being a coward.
Yeah. He's just like, what the dude? Like, do you have a dick? Like, you have a pair? Like, what do you like?
Because he's trying to be like a noble person.
He's
like,
also, he's a little boy. Like, he gets more excited talking to the big bad samurai than he does about women because he just doesn't know it. You know, it's not there yet.
And then at the same time, they hear horse and he, like, they go look and they found three scouts that were scouting the village. And so that kind of ends that scene of like, well, they didn't have sex.
That's the beginning of the contact between him and the bandits. Because they don't know when the bandits are going to come. They're like, okay, we got to get the barley harvested and make sure our traps are set in place or whatever before the bandits come. So when the bandits come, they're scouts. That's the first thing. So they're like, shit, we got to fucking hide all the samurai because if they see that there's samurai here, they're going to know what's up.
Right.
The jig is up or whatever. We just wanted them to see that we've put up these fortifications, these walls or whatever. So this is the first time that we get to see
Before that, I don't know if it happens after this. But this is the greatest thing about, I can't believe this is still in the movie, like in the film, on a Blu-ray disc, there's an intermission.
Oh, yeah, that's
right. There's a 3-minute, it just says on the screen in Japanese, it's kanji, probably tradition, I don't know if it's kanji or not, but it just says intermission.
Can you imagine going to see this movie in the 60s or 70s?
It makes sense in the theater.
It's a 3.5-hour-long movie.
At home, it's like, you can pause it, they still threw in the intermission.
Yeah.
It's great, it just plays a little music for like, it's just a black background with a white title card. This is intermission.
I forgot about that. That's funny.
And you just, it's like 3.5 minutes and then you go and the movie picks back up again.
Yeah.
Also, did we say that this movie has like wipes? Like scene transitions. It has wipes.
Well, I mean, if you haven't heard about it at this point, like George Lucas ripped off everything that he did in Star Wars from Kurosawa films. Like one of those things being the left to right screen.
And they're great because they're so weird. They're so out of place, but they actually feel cool.
Yeah.
So yeah, the scouts are there. They're hiding. The scouts see them and he goes, and the really, really good sword master goes, I'll go get him.
Yeah. He does it several times. Like, this is like the badass ninja in the group. Like, you've seen this in movies. Like, you have like a group of people and you have the one guy who doesn't talk much, but he's just better than everybody else. But he's not a leader. He's not like a good friend. He's not going to say anything funny. He's not going to. But
he's like your lieutenant. Like, this guy gets the fucking work done.
He gets the shit done. Yeah. And so it's like, I'm going to go. Kukuchiro's like, I'm going to go too. Sure.
Because I'll help out. And then.
Katsushita's like, go ahead and go and watch them. Because, like, Kanbe is sort of taking him on at this point as a pupil. He's like, you're learning how to be a samurai. Just go watch. Don't do anything, but just go watch him.
Right.
So they go chase down the scouts and they kill him.
It's great because you see, like, Kukuchiro, like, climb a fucking tree.
Yeah.
And he's, like, scouting. And then the kid's laying in the grass, in, like, the flower bed and watching.
Yeah.
And the stone-faced dude is just sitting by a tree, his eyes closed, just waiting.
That's right. He just sits fucking down. He just sits his ass down and just waits patiently.
And then when they come around the corner, he just stands up. They go, whoa! He just pulls the sword out, cuts one down, runs over, cuts another one down, and then they capture the third. And I wrote down in my notes, like, this is what's cool about this shit, is that the reality of it is this is how fast a battle is over.
Right.
It's over in 5 seconds.
Especially with samurai swords.
Right. And of course, so it's 54. The action is, you take it for what it is. I mean, it's a lot of, like, kind of goofy, not goofy, but like, oh, it's a sword swipe. There's no blood and people, but you just... Okay, good. You know, it's 54. There's no special effects and shit. It's just like you take it for what it is. But yeah, slice, run, slice, done.
Yeah.
That's
and
it.
And that's what you probably imagine that's what it was like. Like those shards, their swords are fucking sharp.
Those are one-hit kills.
Yeah, and that's it. You're done. Samurai fighting was not about like long, protracted, like, you know, choreographed fight scenes or whatever the fuck. Like it was literally like, who can cut the other first?
It's like a joust.
Yeah.
Two guys go at each other and one prevails and the other one's gone and it's over in a heartbeat.
Right.
But yeah, it's really impressive because there's a lot of times in the movie where there's just, like you said, even the very beginning with the hostage, in, out, guy's dead.
Yeah.
Whoa, that was fucking quick.
Yeah. So one of the things...
I want to talk about the scene. They take the hostage back.
Yeah.
And these guys are going, help me, help me. And the villagers are trying to, like, just beat the shit out of him. And the guys are like,
samurai
stop.
Samurai's holding them all back.
Yeah, stop, stop, stop. You can't, he's pleading for his life, you know, you can't just murder him, he's tied up.
Right.
And then the old fucking lady shows up with like a pitchfork kind of thing.
Yeah.
And they don't do nothing, they just let her go.
She's so fucking old, she's had like everything taken from her.
He goes,
like,
let her avenge.
Anybody is justified in taking out this asshole.
He goes, let her avenge her son.
But then they go, help her.
Yeah.
Because she's too old to do it. Yeah. So they're like, yeah, they all jump in and fucking kill him. But this is also where they introduce one of the motifs in the movie is also like a facilitator plot, which is pretty amazing, which is on their big map that they have of the whole village, they have a tally because they know they know how many bandits there are.
Yeah.
And so they start crossing off circles.
Well, they haven't started yet.
No, this is 1, 2, 3.
Oh, you're right. So they have like 30 circles.
It's 3 bandits down.
They had a bunch
40.
Of,
it's 40.
Well, it's 40, but before this they
they haven't done that yet.
That's why they haven't crossed them out yet. So basically they go, where's the camp? They know where the camp is. They go and they just, real quickly, they find the bandits camp and
it's
they're...
Like, yeah. They're hanging out where they have sex with ladies and drink and stuff.
It's the girls they steal.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
And so basically they have a big hut or a big building and they're all sleeping in there. And the guy says, let's just burn the building down. And as they run out, we'll just cut them down.
Right.
So they do that. They kill a bunch of them. The Rikichi is there.
Right, and he's been weird because people have asked him about his wife. Why don't you get married? And he's like super sensitive about it, but you don't know why.
Turns out his wife had been like captured by bandits. And it's weird because I guess this is another Japanese culture thing. She comes out, so they start the fire, they're looking inside, and she sees the fire, but instead of telling everybody, she kind of
just like, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Like this.
Because
like,
I bet you she just like, fuck these people.
Yeah.
But then she comes outside and she sees Rikichi and she runs back in to kill herself.
She's just too ashamed.
It's like, oh, but we rescued you.
Right, but she's
Why are you ashamed?
Yeah.
It's a very Japanese thing,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And in the process, Rikichi's all pissed off and Heihachi's going to like.
Heihachi is trying to go
Heihachi,
get him.
Yeah.
Like, because he's the one who was joking about the wife. He feels like kind of responsible for making him angry.
And he's trying to pull him back from running in the burning building. And I said to myself during this scene, which I haven't watched it in a couple years. I said, it's kind of dangerous to be playing with a sword and grabbing somebody. And of course, what happens, he accidentally stabs him.
No, he gets shot.
No.
He's shot.
He's
shot. There's a fire crack. He's shot.
No, because okay, here's what my take on it. He was trying to pull him back. They're falling in the water and shit. Rikichi was holding a sword. I think he accidentally like stabbed him or sliced him with the sword because they were kind of like wrestling.
Maybe, but I'm pretty sure if you go back and you watch it, you'll hear a rifle shot.
I'll go back and look at it.
That's the whole thing is they were out in the open because they
could
were
do
like,
it right
they
now,
were,
but
they
I don't
were
have...
staying behind cover and stuff like that. And he ran out to go get him and he got shot.
Okay, so anyways, Heihachi
because they have 3 rifles. That's another like fun like. Battle plot, like just strategy plot.
Muskets,
thing in the
they call them.
The bandits have 3 muskets,
but they're more like actual rifles. They're not like buckshot. They're not blunderbusses.
No.
They're actually
they can sharpshoot somebody from a ways away.
Right. But Heihachi dies right here.
So he's the first casualty.
And it's fucking depressing because he didn't even die in a fight. And
also, their whole thing was like he was supposed to be the person.
The morale.
He was supposed to be the person that was keep us like all feeling good in a situation like this. And now he's dead and somebody says that.
Yeah. And there's a scene later on with like the way they do a grave. It's like there's a big pile of dirt.
Yeah.
The sword sticking out of it.
Yeah.
And it's super somber and super sad. Cause you're like, I like that guy. And
so Kukuchiro, who is also sort of the comedy relief. Really, you think like Heihachi's the guy who's supposed to be telling jokes and keep his morale up, like who's Kukuchiro? And I'm like, Kukuchiro's the same fucking guy. Like he ends up picking up the slack essentially. Like he goes and he runs and he gets the banner, which we didn't mention.
So I was saying, Kukuchiro, also he's like making the kids laugh.
Right.
He's making fun of Yohei a lot.
Right. Well,
and
you find out that he was a villager. Like he was a farmer. Like
well,
that's his background.
I mean, jumping around back and forth between time. Yeah, he gives a whole spiel about basically, God. So the banner, the guy with the morale, Heihachi, he creates. They go, what are you doing? He's like, I'm making a banner. Has 6 circles, 1 triangle, and then like a Japanese character.
It's a kanji for field.
Well, it also looks like a field.
Yeah.
So he goes. There's 6 circles there. There's a field. There's a triangle. He's like, but there's 7 samurai. He goes, those are the samurai.
Yeah.
He goes, well, there's 7 of us. He goes, oh, the triangle, that's you, Lord
Kukuchiro.
Yeah. Like,
yeah,
you're such a badass. We made your own. And yeah, so during Heihachi's death, he goes and grabs the banner and runs up on top
like
of
on
one
top
of the big
of the buildings,
buildings and
yeah.
sticks it up there.
Yeah.
So like, you know, try
like
to die
solidarity,
with some honor.
You know, and it works for the most part.
And so with him being the comic relief now, he's making fun of Yohei at one point, and he goes, where'd you get this spear from? Because they made bamboo pole spears.
Right.
But he has one with the actual
spear.
Blade.
Yeah.
Turns out the villagers have a bunch of weapons and armor
right.
that I took it as like there was a battle, and a bunch of bandits got killed, maybe even feuding bandits and like samurai or something like that, and they came in when the aftermath and took all the weapons and armor off the dead bodies.
No.
But it turns out they're supposed to say that they killed a bunch of like...
Yeah, I mean, imagine
but
like...
But how? They were like the bunch... They're the biggest bunch of wimps.
There's still 200 of them. Can you imagine like one injured samurai like hobbling his way, like trying
but
to get away?
But they had like a lot. They had like multiple armors, multiple weapons.
That's what that telegraphs is how much fucking conflict there has been. Like, that's how long there's been wars.
I guess you're right. If it's like one at a time, they keep like picking them off. But I took it as like there was a fight and they killed like a dozen of them.
I think that's letting them get away with too much. I think you need to indict them here. Like, this is a village that they did kill runaway samurai. That's what they did. They hunted them down like dogs. And so there's a whole thing where like the samurai are kind of like ready to, well, that's fucking awful. I'm not going to help these people anymore.
Yeah.
Like, this is terrible. And it's a pretty amazing scene because Kukuchiro, he's sort of like, he does kind of a satirical thing where he goes like, oh, and they're hiding this and they're hiding sake. And look under the boards, they have gold. They're so full of shit. All they do all day long is just try to make you feel bad for them. But really, they're a bunch of assholes, right? And you get so multiple things happen in the scene. One, you go.
And it's all a close-up shot of just him yelling at the camera for like a good 30 or 40 seconds and crying.
Yeah. So you right off the bat, it's kind of obvious. You're like.
It's a really good scene. It's making me kind of like feel emotional right now. It's a really good scene.
He's a farmer. Like, you get that. Like,
well, he was born a farmer.
He was born a farmer that didn't, like, he wants to be a samurai.
Yeah.
Like, but he's too familiar with these things. Like, he knows this. And then the other thing is that he simultaneously makes you go, like, ew, gross. They hunted down samurai. That seems kind of horrible.
Right.
But then the way he talks about it, you're like, fuck, imagine if you did grow up in a place where your life just fucking was horrible.
Well, no, he says, what do you expect them to do?
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like this they is, need to survive. But also, like, in terms of the way that you look at a samurai, the way you look at somebody with armor, imagine your whole life is just fucked over by people with guns. You're just whole life. All I want to do is just live in this fucking village. All we're not even trying to do. We just want to eat. That's all we want to do. We're going to have babies. And we're going to eat. We're going to feed the babies. And those babies are going to grow old. They're going to have babies. That's all we want to do.
Right.
And you just fuck shit up. You can't let us live in peace because all of you fuckers are always fighting each other. You make our lives a living hell. I hate you.
Yeah, because he even says things that's like, what do you expect? During war, the first thing you would do is you would burn all the villages, the food production to starve your...
Yeah.
Even though the farmers aren't the ones that are your enemy, you kill all the farmers to prevent the food production for the people who you are fighting.
He's essentially saying that just like by being a soldier by default, you fucking suck.
Yeah.
Like you fucking...
Because these are the people you pick on.
And you should be sympathetic to the people that like are the literally lowest rung of the totem pole in this world.
Totem poles don't have rungs, though.
You know what I mean? Lowest rung of the ladder. Lowest part of the totem pole. The totem pole ladder.
The lowest carving on the totem pole.
And it's an amazing...
You're the lowest link on the totem pole.
It's an amazing magic trick because I also go like, yeah, that's kind of fucked that they like kill samurai. But then by the end of that scene, I'm like, yeah, I get it.
Yeah.
I get it.
See, I took it as like when that scene started, I felt it was like, oh, there was like a big skirmish and they were like... Which also would be super disrespectful. Right. They were taking all the armor off the dead bodies and the thing. So that's what I thought was
No, because there's too many words like hunting.
Right.
Like
so hunting and I got that kind of as time went on. We talked about it, but and then Gambei goes, "You were a villager, huh?" It's like, well, no fucking shit. Yeah. Like, come on.
Yeah.
And then they all kind of like change their tune. They all kind of like fuck.
It's just amazing levels of like they're samurai, so they're a different class. They feel bad. They feel bad for the villagers on some like objective sense. Like I give money to a homeless person because I feel bad.
Well, they don't.
Right. But like in the scene, like this is where like, wow, we still don't totally understand what you guys go through. Like we don't totally understand like the depths of hell that you guys live in. Like,
you're
in
tortured.
Day-to-day existence.
Yeah. Also, there's a scene that happens much earlier with a young kid who was born into the samurai world. He gave the farmer some money to buy the rice.
It's a great scene.
I mean, I didn't want to go into detail about it, but he shows that like he has nobility and money.
Right.
But he has like this empathetic heart. And he also says it to the girl at one point. He's like, she's like, oh, I'm being born a farmer. He's like, I feel like shit for being born into a samurai family because I feel worthless. Like, I feel like this is... And she's like, oh, I wasn't trying to be...
Right.
He goes, no, it's how I feel.
Right.
That's why I'm helping because I don't like myself. I don't like the world I lived in.
Real quick, because that character you could be throwing away is just the rookie character. That's what he is. But like,
rookie.
He's rich. All the other characters are poor, and it's a quick thing.
But he hides it.
And nobody says it. This is what I think. It's just like you...
No, he even tells the farmer, he's like, don't tell him I gave you money.
But that's it.
Right.
It's never brought up ever again in the movie.
Right.
Like, he literally just throws some money and somebody says, don't say anything. I don't want anybody to know I'm rich.
Right.
I'm trying to learn how to be a samurai, okay? Stay cool, guys.
Yeah. Don't make me look bad in front of my boss.
Yeah. I'm fucking just like these guys, all right?
Yeah.
It's fucking great stuff. All right, so the bandits start finally attacking. Now everything's out. The cards are all on the table. Like, we've already attacked their base. Now that, like, they're coming, we got to start defending the village. The movie switches into action mode at this point.
Oh, God. So here's one of the... Okay, so yeah. So the assault is starting.
Yeah.
What happens is the bandits keep going around from one spot to the other trying to find a way in.
Right.
They build the fence. They put the moat out. Right. And they're going, ha, ha, ha. They weren't expecting that fence there.
Right.
So they aren't actually getting into the village yet. They're trying to poke the, you know, the defenses to
find
where the holes
are. Which shows how fucking dumb the bandits are. They just take villages all day long that nobody ever puts up a fight. Like, you can tell.
Yeah. So here's a great fucking scene. This is just, this is Kiku at his fucking greatest. They first, they go to the fence and they go, oh, we can't get in there. They go around and there's like another like moat with fence.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's three muskets. Be wary of the three muskets. They keep telling each other, like, make sure you don't get shot. Kiku just walks out there, fucking badass. Like, and the bandits are pretty far away on their horses. He just walks out, and he has a swagger walk.
Yeah.
He walks up, he's like, come on, what are you going to do? And then if it goes, pew, and a fucking bullet ricochets off the water, he goes, oh, shit. And he turns around and starts running away. Like, oh, shit, like, they're going to try to shoot me. It's just great to see his bravado, but his realisticness of just like, oh, that didn't turn out well. Like, I'm a fucking idiot. But yeah, it's like a good, like, it breaks the tension.
Yeah.
Because shit's about to go down, but he's still just like, I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
And it's great because you tell his character he's ready to die.
Yeah.
He doesn't care.
Yeah.
But he wants to do a noble thing, but he's really like, he's torn inside.
Yeah.
If anyone else besides the farmers, which, you know, he was a farmer, he is so torn between what he wants to be and what he is. Because at one point he's helping the farmers.
Right.
He's looking for girls.
Right, right.
And the rest of the summer's like, you know, leave that shit alone.
Yeah.
But he's having a good time because it's like, this is what he grew up and he lived it.
Yeah.
But he's trying to get away from that. But he's also like, fuck these stupid, like, they're such a bunch of pussies.
Right.
They don't stand up for themselves.
Right.
They deserve to get their shit burned to the ground.
Right.
But at the same time, he's like, no, fuck the bandits because those people make our lives a living hell.
And also at the same time, fuck the samurai for thinking that you're better than everybody else.
Yeah,
like,
so
you don't know what it's like.
He's so torn. He's just ready to die in any way, but he's trying to, like, live life, I guess, you know? Best character in the movie, I think, by far.
Yeah.
He starts as a stray dog and ends up being some kind of, like, he has a noble purpose, but he's such an emotionally torn character.
Right.
But yeah, I love the fire into the gun, and he's like, ooh, and then he runs away. What happens? The young kid is telling Kiku, this is after, I don't know, I can't remember when it happened now, about the swordsman that killed the scouts. But, or, like, no, that he went and got a... So,
right, so he's
okay,
like...
Okay, wait, sorry, let me back up. I would do it. So they try to attack, and the guys, they take off.
Because
they're like, okay, we can't penetrate into here. We'll come back with a better plan.
They basically funnel them to one spot. They say, like, this
but
is
they don't they don't attack then. They come back later at night with, like, more scouts.
Right.
They try to, like, sneak in the thing. There's a little bit of a fighting.
Right,
they kill a bunch of them. They go, fuck, they got these guns. Like, they try to go through the moat, realize they can't do it. They try to go this way, they can't do it.
Yeah.
They try this way. And then eventually Kambei is like, now they're going to come through the one opening we left them.
Right.
We're going to funnel them into one spot.
Right.
But they have these guns. And they go, well, when are they coming? Like, I don't know. They're going to come, whatever. He goes, watch. They put a scarecrow, basically, on a stick.
A dummy, yeah.
They stick it out, and it gets shot by the gun. So he goes, see, I told you they are out there waiting.
Yeah.
And they have sharpshooters. So he goes, we need to get one of those guns. And then, of course, they send the stone-faced
badass
guy. And he goes, I'll go get one.
Yeah.
And he leaves and comes back. He comes back in the morning. He just hands him a gun.
The passage of time thing. Like, it took him all fucking night. Like, he goes out at nighttime, and he comes back at daytime. You're like, he just was fucking out there for hours, like slinking around and, like, being quiet. And like, and then he came back and he said three more down.
No. He hands him a gun and goes, I got two of them while
two
I was
more,
out there.
Yeah.
And he goes, sits down and just goes to sleep.
Yeah.
Like,
wake me when they come back.
I'm tired. Like, and then the young kid is so fascinated by that.
It's like Michael Jordan. He's just like, you're so awesome.
And he's staring at him. He's like, I just want to say you're great. And he's just like, he no reaction. Just leave me alone. Let me sleep.
It's like Chris Farley and fucking like, hey, remember when that thing happened? That was great.
But and the kid after that, he goes and talks to Kiku, and he's talking to him about what happened.
Right.
Again, subtitles. I don't know what the direct translation is, but I wrote it down and it made me laugh so hard. Kiku's in there scratching himself like always, like a fucking dog with fleas and shit. And he's laying there and goes, like pretty much verbatim, he just says, the story. He's like, I'm not bored at all, I swear.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, oh, yeah, 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 this yeah. isn't boring me, I promise. This is totally not fucking boring as
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, he's being sarcastic, yeah.
It's just like, I love they were sarcasm there. He's like, yeah. Oh, I'm not bored at all, I swear. Yeah, this is a great story you're telling me.
But secretly, he's super jealous. He's like,
oh, my God.
Oh, he's like, I want to do something cool like that.
Because what he does next is, after there's another fight, he goes, watch my post, and he runs out.
Right.
And kills a couple bandits. Oh, no, great. I don't want to talk about this forever, but he goes and he finds one of the bandits.
So many good fucking scenes. You can't help it.
Yeah. He goes, he smells, I smell gunpowder. So he's like, the guy with the gun's around here somewhere, right? They got two guns left. He finds the guy with the gun. He's overlooking the entire village.
Well, first he kills.
I thought he kills a couple people, right?
He kills a couple people first because then he takes their outfit.
Oh, no. He's hiding. He found their camp with all the horses.
Yeah.
He goes up in a tree and he's watching. And two of the guys were trying to desert. They're trying to get dessert.
They were trying to go
AWOL.
That's right, yeah.
And they go, this is what happens if you turn yellow and run away.
Right.
We kill our own kind. Right. You can't run. And so he goes with the dead body, pokes it a little bit,
yeah.
And he takes the helmet thing, goes over and finds the guy with the gun.
He just sits down right
next to him. And just sits down right next to him like, how's it going? Totally.
He's like, oh, this fucking sucks being a bandit. Shoot.
And the gunner's like, these guys are putting up a good fight.
And then he kind of puts out his hands, like, hand me the musket. Like,
No, he doesn't even do that. They're talking, he's like, oh, these fucking villagers, like, they put up a fight. He's like, I don't know. He goes, we're going to have good spoils eventually. Yeah. And as they're kind of just shooting the shit, he just kind of clicks the musket, touches it, clicks it, waits a couple more seconds, kind of just grabs it with both hands, just kind of looking it over, hands it back to him. Yeah. Like, doesn't ask for it. He just grabs it, just kind of looking at him. The guy's just like, looks like he's smoking a cigarette almost, you know?
Yeah.
And he goes, yeah, kind of fucking sucks. I'm gonna. And he just sits there and he pulls his fucking sword out.
Yeah.
And he just looks at the fucking guy. And the guy goes, oh, shit.
Yeah, he puts it together.
Yeah. And then, of course, rather than just straight out, like, slice him, he chases him a little bit.
Yeah.
Then slices him, grabs the gun, and all of a sudden, here comes the fucking posse.
Right.
So he has to run away.
You got a contrast here, because the badass, like, went out and did everything and then came back and probably nobody fucking knew it. Like, they woke up in the morning and were just like, shit, there's two more bodies and one of her muskets is gone.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, fucking Kukuchiro is kind of like, ah! Like, he's running away from the entire fucking bandit posse.
Yeah. And then, of course, he makes a spectacle out of it. He's running, and they hear him. So they're like, wait, are they attacking? And he goes, oh, it's fucking him. I'm like, what? Why is he being chased by all the guys?
Yeah.
And he's like, and he turns around, and he points the gun at him. And he's like, and they go, whoa.
Yeah.
And they do that scene where they're like, oh, shit, gun, you know. And he fires it, and it just fucking knocks him on his ass. And he runs a fucking backwards somersault. And, of course, he runs in like, ha, look what I did. And Kanbei's like, you fucking idiot. Like, you left your post.
Yeah.
He goes, look what I did. He's like, there's no fucking glory in being a hot shot.
Right.
And he gets pissed. He's like, throws the gun on the ground. He's like, fuck you, right?
But he's right.
Yeah.
Like, because a couple more people die because he wasn't in his post. And Yohei dies.
Because he was the one guarding
his post. And Yohei's like his buddy. Like,
he makes fun of him all the time,
but like, he's like the poor farmer. Like, he sees himself in a little bit. Like, he feels like Yohei dies. That's a big deal. That's like him, like, realizing he fucked up.
Not to mention, there was a scene where they, so the village, there's three outlying buildings that they said that we have to just let these buildings go. We can't defend them. And some of the families are like, fuck you, there are houses and stuff. Right. He's like, no, by trying to save you three, we're going to lose all of them.
Yeah.
So either you sacrifice three and keep 20, or you lose all 23.
You got to stay a part of the team.
The old man's lives out there. He won't leave. A husband, wife, and child go to get the old man.
Yeah.
And then he goes, wait, what happened to them? They run over there, and he's like, it's like, come back.
Yeah.
And Kanbei goes with him. The lady comes out of the house. She's been stabbed. She's holding the baby. She hands the baby to Kiku, and then she kind of, like, dies. And then Kiku makes a really big statement of, like, this is me.
Yeah.
This baby is what happened to
me. My whole family was, like, slaughtered by bandits.
And I was, like, an orphan, and someone just kind of picked me up, and then, you know, who knows? So it was a very important scene to more of his backstory, but you kind of already got that.
Yeah. Also, that part, though, where, like, about the houses, you brought it up. Like, so the people that live in those houses sort of, like, they have, like, a little mini uprising for, like, 5 seconds. They're like, well, fuck it. If you guys are going to protect our houses, we're not going to help protect anything. And they, like, run away with their spears. And I just want to bring it up real quick because it's one of my favorite scenes. Like, Kanbei, who's, like, this super cool and collected fucking, like, nice guy this whole time, he fucking whips out his sword and starts running at these guys.
He says, go back
right now. Get in your fucking post.
Yeah, pick up your spears, but it's very much like, get in your goddamn hole.
Get in your And then, but then, in typical
Kanbei
fashion.
Get in your foxhole.
In typical Kanbei fashion, he stops being, like, a hard ass and says, look, everybody, if you can't defend the houses, like, the whole fucking your houses and have the village. It's gonna one or the other.
Yeah.
Like, you can't have both.
So at this point now it's just time to actually fight. They have good tactics of, like, let let one or two guys in on horse and then block the thing with spears.
Right.
We'll kill the two guys that come in.
It's like letting a ball into a pinball machine. Like it's you're fucked.
He said we're gonna pick them off a couple at a time until we whittle them down, and then they keep crossing them off the banner the banner, but the map.
Right.
And you know, you eventually get to a point where it just becomes as far as it's like a couple guys die here and there. It's bow and arrows.
They get shot, you know.
Yeah.
It sucks. Gorbe dies. It's a bummer.
And then it's fucking God who. And then, so it's fucking last, pretty much the last battle. They said
there's literally there's 13 of them left.
They get to a point where, like, the tomorrow's tomorrow morning is they're like, go home, see your wives.
Right.
They go, oh, this must be tomorrow, must be the last day. Then it's like,
yeah,
go ahead and get some sleep. You guys can see your wives. And Kiko's like, go make love to your wives. And all the guys start laughing and the kid sleeps with the girl.
Yeah.
They kind of get together, and then the dad's like, you shame slut, whatever.
Right.
But then the last battle ensues. It starts fucking raining, of course.
It's just incredible.
And it's just a goddamn mud swamp. Just like, it must have won, realistically, shooting this. Goddamn.
Yeah.
The amount of horses, the people that could have gotten trampled, how much work it must have been to run through the goddamn mud all the time. Yeah. I've been saying goddamn a lot because this movie is goddamn. Like, it makes you feel that a lot.
So what's amazing is just that you have, like, people falling over. Like, there's not, like, there was... Unglamorous is the word, because I mean I haven't watched 10 million movies made before 1954, but I bet you most of them, action films, swashbuckling films or whatever, are a lot more
choreographed or,
they're a lot more you know, this is just like they're down in the fucking mud, people are missing, like they're falling over, you know, like
imagine they have like a gutter system, imagine they have like a gutters, there's a part where there's like a little bit of water runs, and it looks to what we would kind of consider, well, that's the gutter, the street.
Yeah, yeah.
There's like shit and piss in it, right?
Yeah.
And there's guys crawling through it trying to get away.
Right, right.
As people are poking them with bamboo spears and stuff.
Right.
They will hunt people down. They like might like, oh, I kind of got a sword slash on him, but he's still alive. And they'll have the villagers go chase him, corner him, and then just poke him with spears till they die.
Basically, yeah.
You know, this is reality. This is war.
Yeah. I mean, fucking Kukuchiro, speaking back to, like, 13 Assassins that we were talking about a few days ago.
Yeah, I was
He fucking, I didn't remember this before, like, but he takes, like, four swords and he sticks them all in the earth.
Yeah.
In addition to, like, his giant sword that he has. Like, what are you doing? He's like, I'm going to need more than one sword to take all these bitches.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happens. He slices down, like, two or three guys with his big-ass sword and it breaks.
Yep.
And then he goes and he's got these other swords that he starts taking up out of the ground.
So I was gonna say, there's a big battle. A lot of the guys, you know, some of the defenses start to break down.
Right.
They get in. They're using the horses to kind of like try to kick. You know, you're using everything they can to get into this damn town.
Yeah.
They're on a. I don't. The bandits at this point are losing, but they're just like, now they're just pissed off.
Right.
They don't even. They might as well just quit. But they're just like, nope. We're gonna fight to the very end. We just want to make it hard. The stone face guy, the sword skilled swordsman. He gets shot and he throws his fucking sword.
I love
sword.
It. Yeah. I hope you were gonna say that. Yeah. Just one last like act of not even defiance.
So what happened here was like the general, the head bandit guy, which you think is the guy with the eye patch.
Right.
But it isn't. It's a different guy. He runs into the room that has all the women.
Yeah.
And he goes, be quiet or I'll kill you all, right?
Yeah.
And he uses the gun and he hides behind, you know, through the window.
Yeah.
And he shoots one of the guys without them seeing. That's what happens.
He shoots Kukuchiro.
Later.
Right.
He shoots the skilled swordsman.
Oh, okay.
And so what happens is he turns around and he looks at where the gun, where the shot came from. And I thought I feel like he's trying to throw his sword at the guy.
He's over there.
Maybe I can get one more. Yeah. Like, he just throws a sword. It's great because that's the kind of guy, like, you think he would die with his sword.
Right.
Like, he would be buried with that sword.
Right, right.
He just like, God, fuck you.
Yeah.
And just threw it.
Yeah.
And then Kiku gets all pissed. Kukuchiro gets pissed. Walks to the goddamn door. And Kamba's like, dude, just come back. What are you doing? Dude just shoots him point blank right in the stomach.
Yeah.
And because Kiku doesn't care.
Yeah, and in typical Kikuchiro fashion, like, he doesn't just go down. Everybody else that's gotten shot just goes down.
Well, he goes down.
But he gets back up.
He gets back up.
Yeah.
And he's just holding his gun.
And I love it. He gets the last kill in the movie. You know, he takes out the bad guy and then dies.
Yeah. And you kind of think like, oh, maybe he had like armor on.
Right.
Like maybe he could survive that, but they're just like, no, he's just dead.
But what was cool about it again is it's just like, that's his fighting spirit. Like he fucking, he got shot, he fell down. I got back up and I took out the leader.
Yeah.
You know, and I got honor, you know, I got to get some honor. You want to talk about just the end of this movie, like thematically,
so
and just like the
what
last
I
line
wish,
and stuff.
What I wish was the last scene in the movie, but wasn't. It's about 30 seconds before the last scene was when Kanbei, his buddy, or not Gorobei, but the other one that's kind of like
his
him.
His friend that he'd been in the wars with.
Yeah. And the young kid are now, Kanbei and the other is
they're the three left of the seven.
Yeah. The Kanbei and the other guy are standing in front of what they consider like the cemetery that they created. Yeah. And then the young kid's kind of standing sideways because the girl goes by and he's looking at the girl and he was going to follow her. But they two have their back to the camera and they're just looking, and there's just four mounds with a sword in each one.
And then all the little mounds and I thought peasants, it's
just,
too.
Yeah, and fuck them. Who cares about the farmers? But it's just, it was a beautiful scene where they're standing there and they're just like kind of like reflecting on what happened.
Yeah.
And I kind of wish it had just ended. Or maybe that would have been the last shot of the movie, just with them standing in front of this hill.
It's a beautifully composed shot.
It's, yeah, because they're at this bottom and the whole hill up.
And the other thing's in the background.
There's four titties across the top of the screen with swords in them, you know. And then the kid goes to chase the girl.
Yeah.
And he's watching and she's singing songs of planting rice. I think he's kind of realizing that even if we loved each other, different worlds.
Yeah.
She's a farmer. I'm not. We can't be together. But he kind of wants to. And then Kanbei just says, you know, we didn't win.
Yeah.
He said the farmer, and the farmers are all celebrating. They're singing music and they're planting rice and they're doing all this stuff and they're having a great time. And Kanbei's like, yeah, I'm happy. But he's like, they won.
Well, before that, he actually says something to his friend about how, like, well, I guess we survived. We're the survivors again. Like,
we survived another one.
You and I, again, are the people that somehow, like, didn't die. Yeah. He says it almost like, this is where I go back to, like, he wanted they all want honorable death. But, like, that's kind of what he was looking for. Like, he says it at the beginning of the movie. He says, we're probably not going to survive this.
Right.
And he seems disappointed when he says, like, we survived again. Like, well, I guess we survived again. Like, yeah. It's kind of a bummer. He's like, I would have gone out on this. I would have been happy to go out on this.
I don't think he was that much of a downer because Kanbei has to rebuttal that with, but we didn't win.
Yeah.
Because he's kind of like, well, we won. Yeah. You know, it's somber, but like we did it.
Right.
And he's like, we didn't win.
Right.
The farmers won.
Yeah.
We lost.
Right.
Because look at, we lost four of our kind.
Right.
They lost maybe five or six or something like that.
I mean, it's also to highlight that difference again between the samurai and the farmers. Like, even though the farmers are like, they're poor, they're fucked, like it sucks. But look, they get to actually live a life.
Right.
They actually get...
Yeah, he says something very much about, like, they... Like, we have nothing to... Our lives, we're supposed to just be...
Yeah.
War,
I'm
battle.
A sword. That's it.
Yeah.
You know?
I'm a tool, and they actually get to enjoy their lives.
Right.
Seven Samurai.
So, you don't need to watch it, because we described it all to you in such detail.
But it's one of those things where, like, if you don't want to take... You know, if you didn't want to take 3.5 hours to watch it, it was a nice way for us to kind of just, like...
I'm actually kind of hoping that...
maybe you heard about this, now you want
to
watch
it. Right. Maybe somebody listened to this enough and, you know... And besides, like, all the amazing character stuff and amazing story stuff, like, the tactic stuff and just action alone is, like, a prototype for so many good movies.
So, now you kind of might see why... Our other video, the Horror Siege...
Yeah.
They're walking around, set up all the traps and stuff. It's like Home Alone,
right.
You know, big scale.
Yeah. Ingenuity.
Yeah.
They're smarter samurais that have survived for years. Even though they didn't win many battles, they know what they're doing. They're smart. They're smarter than fucking bandits. Even if there's less of them. It's pretty good stuff. So we don't need to like talk about and discuss about what we're going to watch next because we already have it. We already know what we're doing. We're going to do a Terminator, right?
It's different, though.
That's a different thing?
I thought that was like a special podcast. Like we're going to do just a Terminator episode.
Another podcast? How about we just let the next podcast be the Terminator thing?
I don't know. Can we talk about 5 movies in...
Maybe if we don't talk about anything else.
That's what I mean. If it was a Terminator only podcast,
yeah,
it'd be
we just get right to it.
I thought it was a bonus one.
I don't know. I mean, it gives us 2 weekends to at least see it also, as opposed to just
I don't wanna wait until but that's 2 weeks from now though.
Yeah, it's fine. Nobody's gonna give a shit about the shitty movie that everybody already knows is shitty.
So for the next project part of our podcast, which might just become the whole podcast, like we're going to go, like I said, I watched Terminator 3 recently again, a little bit of Salvation. Going to try to go back, watch 1 and 2 and actually Salvation from beginning to end. And with Terminator Genesis coming out this week, we're going to basically watch all 5 movies like we've done before. 5.
Terminator. Oh, fuck, it's 5.
Terminator 1, 2, 3, Salvation,
shit,
and now this one.
I keep
one.
Forgetting about 4.
So we're going to watch all the Terminator movies and then just have a little franchise discussion. We're not going to talk about...
I mean, we've done it before. We won't do it. We won't talk for
We're not going to do what we did before with Fast and the Furious, Hellraiser. We're not going to go into a lot of plot. We're going to probably just talk about...
Just reactions to the movie.
What made Terminator good?
Yeah.
What made Terminator suck?
Yeah.
And where the franchise has kind of gone.
And is it just done? Should we really just
should have been
making
done.
Terminator movies?
Should have after...
Seriously.
Should have after 3. 3 was...
And which one's better, 1 or 2?
Hmm? Are we doing that thing?
Hmm?
Well, you'll have to find out when you listen to the podcast.
All right.
I'm going to go with...
I'm tired and hot.
I'm going to go with 2.
I don't know. I haven't seen them in a while. Jeff Gertzman fucking...
I know.
...made quite the case.
Number one is for what it is and what time and the way it was built, absolutely, it's a better movie. But number 2 is a better movie.
Yeah,
you know, it's
yeah,
just got
yeah.
everything in it, and it's fucking great. But number 2 relies heavily on number 1.
Yeah.
So Yeah,
join us next time
in 2 weeks. I don't know what days these are going to go up because we record them. So we record these on Monday, but whenever I get around to editing them and put them up, so it might be like Thursday by the time.
Whatever.
You know.
Up next is Terminator.
No one gives a shit.
They're probably streaming places. They're probably easy to get. I don't know.
Yeah. And obviously you have to go to the movie theaters to see the newest one.
Yeah, and you guys are, what else are you going to go see? You're going to go see Jurassic World again? Hopefully you're seeing Mad Max for the fourth or fifth time.
Yeah, actually, given a couple weeks, we'll give time people to actually see it, maybe, so we can actually talk about the movie.
Yeah.
So, yeah, join us in a couple weeks. We'll talk about more bullshit between what happened in our lives.
Actually, go fucking see Seven Samurai if you haven't seen it
yet.
That's the big takeaway from here.
I mean, if anyone's listening, I'd be like, you fucking, well, email us. We didn't even give an email address out. Website's coming, you know, like,
yeah,
it'll be there. Comments in the YouTube video, just questions. I don't care. Tell me what you think about Seven Samurai. Did you watch it and go, oh, goddamn, it was good. Thank you. Yeah, join us in a couple weeks. We'll do this again. More stupid stories of our lives, and then another movie analysis, I guess.
Yeah,
we'll get to comic books, we'll get to video games, we'll get to another book, and stop being movies all the time. But for now, it's movies. All right,
good night,
peace out.